Good morning to everyone, and welcome, and to those tuning in. We meet this morning to hear the status of actions taken by the NRC and industry in response to lessons learned from the Fukushima Dai-ichi accident. Our first panel, we will be joined by Joseph Pollack, Vice President of Operations and Chief Nuclear Officer of the Nuclear Energy Institute, Bill Patissa, Senior Vice President and Chief Nuclear Officer, Duke Energy Corporation, Patrick Mulligan, Chief, Bureau of Nuclear Engineering, Division of Energy Security and Sustainability of the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection, and Mr. David Lockbaum, Director, Nuclear Safety Project, Union of Concerned Scientists. Before we begin, I want to acknowledge the fact that this is the first NRC Public Commission meeting that I am chairing. I am very grateful and humbled by President Trump's designation of me as Chairman of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Before we begin, I just wanted to address a comment, first of all, about how grateful I am for the service of former Chairman Burns. Many of you know that he has a very long association with the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and also, after a brief period abroad, returned as a commissioner, then so ably stepped in a somewhat unexpected request with the departure of Chairman McFarland. And you know, I want to say that personally, I have a long career in public service, and so does Commissioner Burns. And again, to me, he's an inspiration and a role model of what is, you know, what is the call to public service? What is it to demonstrate such commitment to an organization? And so please join me in acknowledging his service as chairman. And for, I wanted to share a reflection about Commissioner Barron as well, so he didn't feel left out. I just want to say that, you know, I knew Steve when he returned to the commission, and I did not know you, but it has been such a pleasure working as colleagues. And I sit here, you know, really grateful. I don't think that I could work with two more gracious individuals than the gentlemen who sit on either side of me. So thank you both so much. And with that, we can turn to the subject matter of the day. It's interesting. Interesting as I prepared for today's meeting to think about the long journey that the NRC as an agency and the industry as well have been on since the tragic tsunami and earthquake event in Japan. It was interesting, on Friday I had an opportunity to be at a U.S. nuclear power plant. I had not visited the operating site there since before Fukushima, and as we took a tour of the site, the actions, the implementation of the post-Fukushima actions were so visible to me. You don't even have to be particularly close to or knowledgeable about all the actions that have been taken and implemented at sites to have it to be struck by the further enhancements that have been made to the preparedness of the sites, their resiliency to withstand extreme natural events and other hazards. So I think it's interesting to prepare for this meeting. I've been here for the entirety of the NRC's journey as we've taken these actions. And as a body of work between the regulator and the industry, the implementation, it's very impressive to me. And so we will hear a status report today, but for those of us who have been here during the entirety of these events, there's a tremendous amount of effort. I think for NRC's part, it would have to be many hundreds of NRC staff that have participated in where we find ourselves today. And it is so evident that we have increased the resiliency and responsiveness of these facilities. So I look forward to hearing from our presenters today. Would either of my colleagues like to add any comments? Commissioner Barron?
Well, thank you for your kind opening remarks. And I had something I wanted to say to Steve and to you. To Steve, I just want to join Christine in thanking you publicly for all of your hard work as chairman. I think you can tell everyone in this room appreciates everything you did as chairman and your efforts. And I want to officially congratulate Christine on her designation as chairman and wish her all the best. We don't always agree on policy, but I respect you tremendously, and I look forward to working with you in your new role.
Thank you very much.
There you go. I have to do it all myself now. No, I want to thank my colleagues for their kind remarks. And, you know, it's interesting, as I said, when I came back from, and I think my wife will still kicks me once in a while for coming back from Paris. But I let her go back when we go back a little bit and all. But it has been an interesting journey, and I appreciate the support that my colleagues have. We've, as Jeff said, we have, I think, good debates, don't always agree, but I think we try to do the best for the American public. And I do wish Chairman Savinicki all the best. She and I were talking the other day, and there is something, and something about this. You are still your own person, but a lot of people think they own a piece of you. And all that. And
I'm finding that out.
Yeah, and I won't go on, actually, most of you know, I was not a nuclear engineer, but I was actually a German major, and there is an old German play by Friedrich Schiller about Don Carlos, which talks about Philip II, the King of Spain. And he's actually, basically, he says, I can't get anything done because all you people are doing things. Well, it's not quite that bad. It's not as bad as it was maybe for the King of Spain. But sometimes though you have to work those struggles through. And I wish you all the success and all the support for that. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you both. Mr. Pollack, I believe we'll begin the presentations with you.
Thank you, Chairman Savinicki, Commissioner Barron, and Commissioner Burns. I don't know how to follow up this introduction you started, but I'll try. I'd like to talk about where we've come from, as you said, over this journey, coming up on our sixth anniversary, actually, the events of Fukushima. Go to the next slide, please. The significant safety enhancements across the industry have been accomplished as a result of the actions taken in Fukushima. The Tier 1 activities, which were the priorities identified by the Commission to move forward on, are substantially complete. The NRC rulemaking aligns with the industry efforts that were taking place, and in this case, many things were done in parallel. So we were working and installing as we were writing the requirements to work and to install. And I think that speaks to the open communications and dialogues that we had throughout this time period. And in fact, by our accounts, there's somewhere over 300 public meetings that discuss these with thousands of participants to make sure that we had clear communications as we continued forward. The focus now is going to be changing from installation to inspection. While inspections took place throughout the time period of installing, the plants have substantially installed the modifications for mitigating strategies, and now we're going into the NRC's inspection of the final installations and going through. So it is a transition taking place. Next slide. The spent fuel pool level instrumentations are completed. I already spoke to the flex implementation. And as we found out subsequently, information is that the fuel pools did survive the events of Fukushima with minimal damage. But the uncertainty surrounding the levels in the fuel pool distracted attention and response. So while information provided later on would identify that it was not a requirement, it was something that was taken on and directed by the NRC, and I think the operators find value in it, having that to be able to focus their attention on what's more important. The hardened vent implementation is on schedule. As you know, that the NRC has required orders and modified those orders as a result of a lot of research activities going concurrently to that development. And we expect those to be completed on time going through. The seismic and flooding evaluations, which were substantial, was we went in to look at new information and could anything change our position? And more importantly, could it change the ability to implement the mitigating strategies with the new information that was developed? And then the support, we do support the staff's recommendations on the Tier 2 and Tier 3 actions. And in fact, the majority of the Tier 2 was consumed and the actions that were taking place for Tier 1. And then the disposition of Tier 3, we concur with the decisions made by the Commission going forward. Next slide. So the flooding hazard reevaluation hazards, as you walk through, are about 85% complete. As you're aware, there's a couple of the sites that were extremely complex, needing the Army Corps of Engineers to do analysis on parts of the flooding plains and the dams that are upstream from that in order for the sites to complete that analysis. But we have completed that analysis. The focus evaluations and the integrated assessments are on schedule through the 2017 and 2018 time period. The focus evaluations, again, were to evaluate whether you could handle the mitigating strategies, still implement those mitigating strategies or alternate strategies as a result of these evaluations. And then the mitigating strategy assessments, as I said, will be completed this year going through. In the area of seismic, the request for the information is about 90% complete by the end of this year. It's on schedule as some of the plans requiring seismic probability risk assessments are scheduled to go out into the 2019 timeframe. And that was understood from the beginning with resources both in the public domain for people capable of performing these assessments as well as NRC staff to review the assessments. And again, the mitigating strategies assessments will be about 80% complete in alignment with the seismic probability risk assessment being complete. And what that means is the sites have went back and looked at their flex and mitigating strategies with the new information they had as a result of these evaluations on seismic to make determinations of would they be able to still implement those strategies or deploy an alternate strategy, and that has been completed in about 80% of the sites. Next slide. The flex inspections. There's a current focus on inspections, and it's important to understand that focus. While inspections have taken place throughout this time period, from the initial inspections for the NRC and walkdowns of the current fleet status prior to modifications, as well to inspections throughout the time period going through. The industry, through all this, has routinely shared the lessons learned. We had held workshops, which the NRC has participated to identify the findings they're seeing so that we could share with the rest of the industry and learn from those, so that the subsequent inspections would not have the same items happen to be revisited, the industry could learn and move. And in fact, we're holding a workshop next month in Atlanta with regional and headquarters inspectors as well as the industry to talk about the going forward. There is a knowledge retention and transfer, and that's taking place both at the NRC and the industry. And what I mean by that is, as Chairman Savinicki said, she's been here through the whole time period. In the industry, that is the case in some, and in many cases, people are starting either to retire or be reassigned to other projects, so new people are taking responsibility. So we're making sure that that knowledge that was captured during this time frame is being transferred to the industry. And as well, the NRC's inspectors are participating to share that knowledge and learning going through that. So it's important for us in the clear communications and the transparency that this information being provided, and we've held those throughout the implementation phases of the mitigating strategies. And then the last points I want to do, we do support the draft final rule as a regulatory centerpiece of post-Fukushima activities. It codifies the work that's been done in response to the NRC orders and combines the work and ensures mitigating strategies remain feasible for the reevaluated hazards. And again, the rule has been thoroughly vetted. Overall, we believe that our comments have been satisfactory to resolve, and that has a lot to do with the 300 plus public meetings I talked about, where we could be very clear on what our concerns were and the staff could voice their concerns and we could come to the understandings so we can move forward. So that concludes my remarks.
Thank you very much. Mr. Patisa.
Thank you. Bill Patisa, Chief Nuclear Officer at Duke Energy, and I certainly appreciate the invitation also from the commissioners and the chairman. You know, it's I listened to your remarks, Chairman, on opening up and talking about Fukushima. All the chief nuclear officers in the country had an opportunity to go there in 2013, and it is absolutely eye-opening, the circumstances that presented themselves and the response that the operators took at that time. And to me, the most valuable aspect of this horrific tragedy is the fact that we are going to get to learn from it and take advantage of things so that they don't happen here. I commit to our operators in every visit to control rooms across our plants that we will make sure they have the equipment, the training, and all the things they need such that that event cannot happen at one of our plants. And I think that's such an important piece of the lessons learned. We can all talk about all the specifics, but that overarching message is just so important because we are a better industry now than before this event happened. And you know, I'm going to talk through representing some of my peers. Quite frankly, it's a little challenging because I think you guys have seen more flex equipment than I will ever have seen in my career because you've been to many plants and seen many things. And it's incredibly important that we keep an eye on the tragedies that happen in Japan and also the application and the ultimate benefits, not just in the U.S., but the entire industry. So if you look very specifically on my first slide, it really talks about the chief nuclear officers got together about 5 years ago and started talking about the flex and ultimately what can we do collectively to respond to an event such that we can take advantage of equipment across sites, across locations. And it's really probably the first time we came together in a way that ultimately led to a common solution to an industry problem. Our history had always been each of us will do it differently. And in this case, we did it in a very common manner. And I'm certainly very proud of the fact that now all 11 reactors at Duke have completed flex, have completed the spent fuel pool level instrumentation. And ultimately, we're very committed to completing the beyond design basis rule events. Next slide, please. So if you look at the implementation of flex and spent fuel pools, I've got some pictures later on, but overarchingly, it does has created a significant level of improvement in safety. And we've established maintenance activities with this equipment. We've given training to our operators. We've tested the equipment. So I'm very confident that if that equipment is needed, it can be utilized by people who know how to use it. And that's very important. And certainly overall, as I said before, I think we are a much safer industry now with the implementation of this equipment. Next slide. So we're still working on the hardened vents at our two units that are boiling water reactors, and we're on a very clear path to closure in the 2018-2019 timeframe, and feel very confident that we'll have that implemented exactly per the orders and rules. Next slide. I always appreciate the pictures. When I look at the domes we built these at the domes at four of our sites. At one of our sites, we were able to use an existing facility, and at one of our sites, we used the three buildings versus the dome. It was our first one, and we weren't sure exactly if the rules were going to change, so we decided it was safer to implement the three buildings. But overall, I'm very, when I visit inside these domes, when I visit the response centers at Memphis and Phoenix, it really conveys that we've got good equipment, we're taking care of that equipment, and if it's ever needed, it's going to be available to us. Next slide. So I had to give you more pictures, and you can look a little bit more at that, but like I say, I know you guys have seen all of this equipment, but we're committed to taking very good care of it and making sure it will work when we need it. Next slide. So beyond just what we've done with equipment, beyond just what we've done with all aspects of building these buildings and putting equipment inside of it, we've also done a significant amount of inspections and analysis. And on this slide, really just trying to convey the level of effort we've done with seismic, with flooding walkdowns, with flooding reevaluations and seismic reevaluations. We're very committed that these industries are not these occurrences are not hypothetical. They're ones that we're going to be able to respond to if they were to actually occur. And that requires inspections and then follow up on those inspections with activities in the plant to make sure that all aspects of the way that we will preserve our ability to safely shut down the reactors will be available, whether it's flood or seismic events. Next slide. And then just the last is just thought I'd give a breakdown of, you know, this has been a large investment by our industry, but it was intimidating on the front end, but I would say in retrospect, it's absolutely been beneficial in every way. And when I look going forward, I think now that we've made these safety improvements to our plants, we'll look at crediting those safety improvements, how we can utilize them more. It can't just be we put this in place and just set it to the side, and now it's a one and done. It needs to be really alive as part of our way of the way we work day in and day out. Now I'm looking at ways during outages that I can go ahead and pre-deploy flex equipment or other things and say, you know, if something were to go wrong, if equipment didn't work right, I've got available backup equipment that I can just readily hook up and use. So I think it's still, there's a wide opportunity now of taking advantage of all the improvements that we've made with this flex equipment, with the analysis we've done, with the inspections we've done. That's all I've got. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Mulligan.
Good morning, Chairman Sinicki and Commissioner Barron and Commissioner Burns. I want to thank you for the opportunity and the invitation to come down and present to you this morning. My topic, I'll be talking about real-time monitoring. And so I'd like to start with an assessment of some of the points that were brought up in the document that was put out recently in December on real-time monitoring. Now, I believe that the current regulations and the guidance that we have in place provides us with a mechanism where we can make protective action recommendations for public health and safety. Prior to the need for even gathering radiation data, I think that the EAL schemes we have, the notification schemes we have, and the processes we have in place for off-site response gives us that capability. However, I believe that the off-site monitoring capabilities are robust. I mean, we have mature off-site response programs that have those capabilities and been developing them for a long time. So I believe that to support dose assessment and those decisions that we make, we have sufficient off-site monitoring capabilities. While I believe that public release of data won't necessarily enhance our decision-making process, I do believe that making radiation data public can be beneficial. I'll talk a little bit about that towards the end of my comments here. Next slide, please. New Jersey was one of the first to install fixed monitoring stations, and we believe firmly that it is an excellent system for early warning and detection of any releases from nuclear power plants. We believe that there are still a couple of EALs in place that where you can actually classify an event based on off-site doses if nothing else is available. So we believe that the fixed monitoring stations that we have in place can provide a good early warning system for us to detect off-site radiation doses. And I can talk a little bit more about that. You know, New Jersey has a fairly robust system around both of our nuclear power plant sites in New Jersey. We've got all of the wind sectors covered at both sites, and that data is transmitted to the state of New Jersey real time, minute by minute, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So we've got sentinels out there constantly. We do believe, next slide please, we do believe so much in this that after a couple of events, one of them was the incident in Fukushima, and the other one was Superstorm Sandy in New Jersey, where we were challenged. And at that point in time, during Superstorm Sandy, our fixed radiation monitoring sites were probably the only way we were going to get any radiation data should there have been an accident at one of those power plants. And as you know, Oyster Creek did go to an alert during that event, and that was really the only way we would have had to monitor off-site. Roads were impassable. It would have been impossible to get field teams out. So we believe that they provide a measure of redundancy for us to our real-time field teams going out. And to support that, realizing how important it was, we tried to make our network of fixed monitoring sites better, and we invested a lot of money in doing that. Redundant network systems, automatic failover on power failures within the state, and accessibility through various means on the internet and intranet for the DEP, and we also have battery backups at each site, and we're actually looking at making those battery backups a little bit more robust so that we can have extended power. Next slide. field data is important, and it's important for us to get data faster. And so we've recently invested quite a bit of funds into coming up with mobile radiation detection equipment. We have 4 vehicles now that can transmit data back to our assessment facility real time. Those are capable of monitoring ambient gamma radiation, air iodine concentrations, and air particulate concentrations, so we can get those in real time as well as the teams are out there gathering data in the field. And we also have plans and procedures that can dispatch additional field teams to supplement that if necessary with handheld instruments. I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about data sharing because that's really important to us, and we've been involved with that for a while. We've been actively involved with CRCPD on their interagency environmental data sharing and communication committee. We were instrumental in helping us draft the policy recommendations that were incorporated into the latest draft of the National Response Framework, the RADNUC Incident Annex. And we're currently involved, and the committee's working on trying to come up with a policy on how we can share public data publicly. We've not reached any resolution on that. It's a tricky subject, but we're still working towards making that happen. Next slide, please. Our real-time data is shared within the state through a web application that we've developed through ESRI, so we share that with our partner agencies, the State Office of Emergency Management, the Department of Health, and others. And we're also working with the federal agencies. We actually were one of the first agencies to share live data with through the RAD Responder Network with our federal partners. So we are sharing that minute-by-minute data in real time with the Department of Energy and Department, the Environmental Protection Agency, and others who have requested it. So we do make that data available. And like I said, that's real time live data that's coming through that network. So we are very interested in sharing our data that we collect with other outside organizations so that everybody has access to it. Next slide, please. The commitment for New Jersey is to make all of our radiation data accessible within the state government to all agencies, and to also making the RAD Responder Network our primary way of means of sharing data with outside organizations, including neighboring states, local organizations, licensees, and with the federal government. And we also are still evaluating the policy recommendations for making radiation data publicly available. And I think a couple of the things, while it doesn't help us make decisions for the public, making that public, I think can go a long way sharing that data with the public to giving them confidence that the decisions that are being made for them are the proper decisions. If I'm told a shelter, if I can go and I can look at radiation data that backs that up, it makes me feel more comfortable with taking that action. Or if I'm told to evacuate and I can actually go look at data that says I need to be evacuating, then it makes me more comfortable with the decisions that are being made. So I think that it can be helpful. However, there needs to be some guidelines on that. I mean, you can't put radiation data out there publicly without context. So we need to come to a consensus about how we can put that out in good context so that the public can understand it and they can't interpret it in ways that it's not meant to be interpreted. So we need to have context. And we also have to have validation and verification before it's made public. We can't just be putting data out there before it's vetted by some people who know what the data means. Obviously, there are times that you're going to collect data and there's going to be mistakes, there's going to be errors. So that we need to make sure that the data before it's made public is validated and verified. And finally, we need to come up with policy decisions. You can't go into an emergency and try to make policy on the fly. We have to have a mechanism set up in advance to have permissions to allow the data to be publicly available. It's not the time when in the middle of an emergency for me to go trying to find a chain of command that's going to help me get that done. So I need to have that in advance so that I am empowered, that I can make the decision that it's my data, that I can release it, and that everyone else is comfortable with that. So those are the 3 things that I think that are really the hurdles that we need to get over to come up with a policy for making data public. And that concludes my comments. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lockbaum.
Good morning. Thanks for this opportunity to share with you our perspectives on the progress made and the steps remaining for the lessons learned from Fukushima. I was a little concerned about duplicating prior presentations, so I appreciate Joe and Bill holding back so I'd have some new ground to cover. I will focus more on the steps remaining, but recognize and appreciate the many steps already taken by the Commission, NRC staff, and industry. We are clearly better off today than we were 6 years ago. Next slide, please. Due to their complexity and breadth, the implementation of the NRC's post-Fukushima lessons learned has been a marathon rather than a sprint. The passage of time reflects that reality and not stonewalling or foot dragging on the part of the NRC or the industry. But it's a good time to ask if we're there yet, and if not, what additional steps should be taken. Given the time constraints on my presentation, I will focus on flood protection and, to a lesser degree, mitigating strategies. We believe these concerns we have about these lessons also apply to many, if not all, the other lessons. Two. Next slide, please. After Fukushima, the NRC required walkdowns and reevaluations to reduce vulnerabilities due to flooding hazards. These requirements were a supplement to existing regulatory requirements that had been in place for decades. In other words, the NRC and the industry had more than a passing acquaintance with flood protection requirements. Next slide, please. The NRC's familiarity with and enforcement of these long-standing requirements helped Fort Calhoun be ready when it became an island in the Missouri River in June of 2011. The NRC did a stellar job at Fort Calhoun, giving us confidence that flooding can be a manageable risk. Next slide, please. But on the other side of the coin, Arkansas Nuclear One's March 2013 event cast doubt on whether that flood risk is being properly managed everywhere. This picture shows the 550-ton stator that dropped onto the turbine deck and crashed through an opening into the truck bay below. The center of the picture shows pipes and cables damaged by the falling stator. Next slide, please. After walkdowns concluded that the plant was adequately protected against flooding, this event clearly showed this conclusion to be wildly optimistic at best, or entirely bogus at worst. The walkdowns had not missed a pathway or two, it missed more than 100. Next slide, please. And Arkansas Nuclear One was not unique. This is a picture showing some of the 50,000 gallons of rainwater that flooded the auxiliary building at St. Lucie in January of 2014 through pathways that the owner had told the NRC simply did not exist. Next slide, please. After performing the flood protection walkdowns mandated by the NRC, the owner gave the NRC a thumbs up. The January 2014 event suggests that perhaps using a different finger may have been more appropriate. Next slide, please. It's hard to suspect, yet alone believe, that these are the only two reactors in the U.S. with defective flood protection measures. Maybe the rest of the reactors got it right, but maybe not seems equally valid situation. Just 2 days ago, I read that 10 nuclear plants in Japan were discovered to have missing flood protection features. These discoveries were made during inspections mandated by the Japanese regulator after 6.5 tons of rainwater flooded the Unit 2 reactor building at the Shika plant in September of 2016. Next slide, please. About 90% of the walkdowns conducted after Fukushima identified deficient flood protection measures against long-standing requirements that had been routinely inspected. Does this mean that only 10% of the plants have properly implemented the post-Fukushima flood protection measures? Being adequately protected against a flood, unless a flood happens, is at least 100% unacceptable. Next slide, please. The mitigating strategies order expanded the post-9/11 upgrades that the NRC imposed by B5B and subsequent rulemaking. These measures have undergone less road testing to ensure they meet their good intentions. Next slide, please. I apologize for sounding like a broken record, but nuclear safety is achieved by the NRC establishing and enforcing proper regulatory requirements. The NRC has established proper regulatory requirements for flood protection and mitigating strategies, but ample evidence strongly suggests that not all reactors meet these requirements. Next slide, please. The NRC's baseline inspection effort and its post-Fukushima temporary inspection efforts have not provided reasonable assurance of adequate protection against flooding hazards and extended loss of power events. The St. Lucie event led to the discovery of defective flooding barriers that had been missed for 30 years, including missed by post-Fukushima focused inspections. We recommend that the NRC conduct vertical slice inspections at 8 plants for flooding protection and mitigating strategies compliance. The results from these inspections would either confirm that we are there or to reveal what additional steps are needed to get there. Next, thank you.
Thank you very much. We rotate the order of recognition for questions, and it happens to fall to me to go first, so I will begin the Q&A period. Thematically, in some of your presentations, I heard you touching on the topic of really what I call sustainment, meaning going forward, you know, the NRC requested and demanded certain actions. Those have been implemented to a very great or very extensive, at this point, extent. But there is the sustainment question, and I take from Mr. Lochbaum's presentation, even if you look at the post-September 11th B5B measures, when we went out and looked at those, you found variability in some of the sustainment measures there. Mr. Battisi, you talked about differentiating between a one and done, I think that was your term, versus keeping the flex programs, mitigating strategies alive. And I would note, you showed pictures of equipment. It's not possible to show pictures of procedures, or you could, but it wouldn't be very interesting. But the key thing is that there is a lot that undergirds the existence of that equipment. There's training, there's procedures, who's going to use it, when are they going to use it. For any of you that would like to talk about the challenges and concerns of this theme of sustainment going forward, maybe for Mr. Pollack and Mr. Battisi, what are the measures that give you confidence in sustainment of you, this new resiliency that you've created at these plants? And Mr. Lochbaum, I'd offer to you an opportunity to address the same matter. Mr. Pollack.
Yeah, thank you, Chairman. If I'll start and then Bill can add on there. The one thing we talked about is a continued workshop and the formation. The industry actually requested that we continue with this going forward, even though we've been implemented, which is somewhat unusual for implementation of regulatory requirements. The second thing is and Bill can talk to more, we're looking to use this equipment, the procedures that we've developed in other areas so that it stays fresh. So whether you're using it for refueling outages, backup equipment, or you're using it for other risk advantages, it's not just a one and done, and it's expanding the use of this mitigating equipment so it doesn't just go sit in some warehouse or storage not to be used other than surveillances. And I think that's what we're seeing. There's been utilities across the country that have utilized this equipment already, have seen the benefit of defense and death just from that application.
Thank you, Mr. Battisi.
I mean, just to echo on that message, it's very true. It's becoming part of our operation of the plant. And that, to me, is the differentiator that makes it sustainable. We'll be using this equipment routinely, whether it's through outages, whether it's through during an ERO drill, whether it's through activities that are going on. Quite frankly, we have even used this equipment for other activities, things like bulldozers and things, to keep people fresh on being able to use them should there be debris that has to be removed, giving them practice on a more routine basis. So, and then on top of that, that's kind of the hands-on aspect of it. But our processes, our procedures, our training, just literally forces a level of refreshment that's going on almost continuously with this equipment. And I certainly anticipate that we'll be viewing this equipment as part of our infrastructure, maybe more so than when it was first put into the dome or in the flex buildings, that ultimately many of my operators, many of my engineers, many of my PRA folks, the folks that are looking at designs and changes and everything else, will recognize this equipment as part of the infrastructure of our plant.
Have you, before I turn to Mr. Lochbaum, though, you know, hearing that, it sounds so logical, but we force ourselves to look at every dimension of things. And are there any potential challenges, though, when it becomes such an integrated part of the overall operation of the plant or is used and invoked in other instances? Because right now, as you walk about in the plants where there is the flex equipment, it has special painting on the floor. It's like, so you know if someone absconded with it and took it and is using it for some other purpose. But has that dimension of sustainment been fulfilled, that it will indeed be there and it wasn't called into service in some other way, that it never made its way back to where a responder is looking for it?
That's a great question, and we are very systematic in the way that we require that equipment to get right back to where it belongs, and then ultimately doing a follow-up inspection to make sure it's back and it works okay. I won't deny we have had some challenges around early on implementation. We had a situation where someone used something, put it back, and didn't reconnect the battery charger. We found it the same day. But ultimately, we have to make sure our processes and procedures are robust enough that give us confidence that that equipment will always be there if it's ever needed. And then the, but the aspect of the other uses, I do think is still an important piece of our path forward. I think we saw problems with B5B equipment because we weren't regularly putting our hands on that equipment. That led to some quite frankly embarrassing revelations when we went back and looked at it as an industry, and our goal collectively, and all the CNOs are very committed to this, is we're going to make sure this equipment never reaches a dormant stage of inactivity that we have seen maybe in other things in the past.
Thank you. Mr. Lochbaum, did you want to talk about the challenges?
Just briefly, I think to add to what both Joe and Bill said is by integrating it into day-to-day or more day-to-day plant activities, I think the benefit from that is if there are some problems, because the Fukushima lessons, the flex equipment is more universal, more standard across the industry, the lessons learned from plant A are more learnable or transferable to other plants. So not only do the lessons benefit that plant, how to do better, but it also it benefits the industry. And that's a little bit different than B5B in the post 9/11. They were both great intentions, but that operating experience value was more diminished on 9/11.
Thank you for that. It's interesting, yesterday at NRC, the Office of Nuclear Security and Incident Response conducted one of our knowledge management seminars. We were very honored to have Governor Tom Ridge, the first Secretary of Homeland Security and the first advisor to the President for Homeland Security after 9/11, addressed us about 9/11, Katrina and Rita, and just he kept using this term of a culture of preparedness and, you know, how as a nation do we develop that, and he reflected a lot on his experiences in those events. But it was interesting to me that, you know, we talked about this notion of no event is actually responded to and addressed from Washington or from a corporate office. It is really the responders on the ground that are the ones that do that. And he spoke a lot about federal-state partnership and also just the integrated law enforcement responders, federal-state, all of that coherency through planning and exercises that needs to come together. So, Mr. Mulligan, you did mention the CRCPD, the work, the input that group, the recommendations and lessons learned they've done in terms of the federal-state coordination. In addition to the data sharing issue and things that you've looked at, do you have any sense of, in general, do you think that the contributions and input through CRCPD have shown improvements and other actions in terms of just our preparedness overall to coordinate maybe a little bit better than we did on the radiation issues post-Fukushima?
I believe they have, and there have been a number of other initiatives that have been cooperatively developed between state, locals, and federal agencies that have improved response. There's a program out there now to develop a radiological operations support specialist, what's called a ROS. So we're training state and local individuals to be experts in response to where we can share that resource with other states. If there were an incident in California, we have people on the East Coast that can go there and support them, because we know that we're going to run out very quickly of radiation experts within the state, and we're going to run out of them at the federal level. They're all going to be busy at Fermac, and so that we need those experts in other areas to be at the local EOCs and the state EOCs to help explain radiation. So that's one of the initiatives that we've done. We've also worked on the advisory team for food, health, and the environment to come up with some other initiatives where the state federal partners can work more cooperatively and improve that response. So the CRCPD has been involved with a number of initiatives. Make public data, Fermac Mac products. We've improved on all of those things. That has only, made our response capabilities more enhanced. So I believe there's been a lot going on.
Thank you. Well, again, I thank each of you for your presentations, and we make reference to this 300 public meetings. I know that each of you and the organizations you represent have been very involved over the last number of years in all of the activities we're talking about today, so I thank you for that effort and those contributions. Thank you very much. Commissioner Barron.
Thanks. Well, thank you all for being here. We appreciate it. Mr. Mulligan, the Commission is currently considering the NRC staff's proposed resolution of three post-Fukushima open items, and one of those is the recommendation to study the efficacy of real-time radiation monitoring at nuclear power plants. I want to get more of your thoughts on fixed monitoring stations because, as you explained during your presentation, New Jersey uses them at Salem Hope Creek and Oyster Creek. Can you talk a little more about the situations where you found the monitoring stations to be useful? You mentioned the example of Superstorm Sandy. Are there other examples? Do you see benefits during emergency preparedness exercises or at other times?
We use them at every one of our emergency preparedness exercises. We have a simulation program that runs, so we're looking at them as we would be looking at them during a real emergency. So we're in tune to those. We use them much like another field team. I mean, if there's one of our fixed radiation monitoring sites located somewhere, we don't need to send a field team there. So we can actually save some radiation dose to some of our field team members by having those in place. On a day-to-day basis, when there was a rain event post-Fukushima, we saw that on all of our monitors. There was a period of time, a four-hour period where it was raining out, that we actually saw some of the fallout from that. That's how sensitive they are. We see radiation fuel shipments in and out and materials going by. And there was also one incident where there was a industrial radiographer doing some work and not using their shielding as they should, and we caught that at one of our sites. So there are a number of opportunities and a number of ways we use that. But first and foremost, it's that early warning system that we can detect prior to anywhere else. Because, and in Jersey, we're kind of close. I mean, we're an hour to an hour and a half away. Other states where the response time from organizations might be longer in a larger state, they could be valuable while teams are in transit to get there. They can give you some real offsite data.
Mm-hmm. And so it sounds like there are some cases where in a Superstorm Sandy situation where you don't necessarily have the use of the monitoring vehicles, and the fixed monitoring stations are useful there. There may be some dose reduction benefits at other times. Are there cases where do you find it useful in terms of directing your mobile monitoring equipment? In other words, you get some readings off the fixed monitoring stations that allows you to zero in on where you're going to deploy the vehicles? Is that a use or not really?
Not really, but it can give us an idea. A lot of the modeling that we do leads us down that road that, a plume is going to look exactly like it does when we do our modeling. And that's just not the case. I mean, if you look at, the modeling results and what really happened at Fukushima or at Chernobyl, it just goes everywhere. So while it doesn't directly tell us where we're going to go, it can redirect. If we're picking up radiation in areas we didn't believe that it should be based on the wind direction and the wind patterns, the micrometeorology in areas can move it all around, especially in an area like Oyster Creek where you have sea breeze effect. Mm-hmm. You know, so they can help us redirect teams to areas where we didn't believe there should be radiation, but there is.
In its evaluation of this issue, the NRC staff focuses quite a bit on a 1982 study that concluded that a monitoring system consisting of 16 or 32 stations couldn't provide reliable information about a potential radioactive plume because the plume could pass between the stations or could be underestimated if a less radioactive part of the plume was what crossed over a station. What do you think about that conclusion?
I'd have to say that I disagree strongly with that. I don't believe that you're going to sneak a plume between two of those. I mean, the shine from a plume that's a significant plume is going to be picked up by one of these radiation monitors that we have. These picks are very sensitive. The other thing is that any data that I get during a radiological incident is valuable data, whether it's a centerline point or an off the centerline point, because I've got, you know, as a health physicist, and knowing if I have an off centerline data, knowing how far that is away from the centerline, knowing where that is, I can back calculate to what the centerline dose is. So for you to for them to suggest that I can't tell what the peak is based on an off center value is just not true. I can do that. And so that I do believe that while you may not be able to get the most accurate data, I mean, you can get data that you can really work with.
Okay. And you mentioned that you either have or you've looked at upgrading the equipment over the years. Based on your experience in New Jersey, how have the cost and reliability of the fixed monitoring stations changed over the last, 30, 35 years?
We are just in this process right now of upgrading our systems. The last time we upgraded was in 2000, so the units that have been on there have been operating without issues for probably close to 17 years. And the only reason why we're replacing them is because the manufacturer is no longer supporting that model. They are still working fine, and we just didn't want to be caught without them, so we're replacing them now. So you're looking probably at a 15 or 20 year life of these. We've only replaced them two times in New Jersey. The original installation was in 88. We upgraded in 2000, and we're upgrading again. And I believe if you're looking at a cost benefit for the amount of time that they're in service and for the amount of protection and data that they give you 24 hours a day, minute by minute, I believe that they're a cost-effective way to maintain surveillance around the site.
Mm-hmm. And do you have a sense, if you're kind of heading into the third generation of these, how have costs changed over time? Is it cheaper or more expensive to do it this time than in 88?
Actually, I believe the costs have either stayed the same or they're a little bit less now.
The Fukushima Near-Term Task Force recommended considering whether radiation monitoring data should be available on the internet, and it sounds like that's an issue you're grappling with in New Jersey. You talked about the importance of validating and vetting that data before it goes out there. If you get to a point where you can validate and vet, what do you see as the pros and cons of releasing information publicly?
I think one of the pros would be public confidence, obviously. I mean, if the public knows that you're getting data and gathering data, you're not sharing with them, they have the sense, at least that from what some of the reports are, that you're withholding things. And when you're withholding information from somebody, there's a level of distrust. So I believe that making that data publicly available will generate trust in the decision makers that are providing the protective actions that they're taking. Again, some of the cons are that if people don't understand what the data means, it could cause a general panic too. If you're looking at something that's twice background and they see that it's doubled, it's going high, and they don't understand that's not a big deal. Then that could create things that you don't want to happen, especially for incidents where there's actually no actions that need to be taken at all. That's the downside of maybe sharing things publicly as well.
Are you hearing interest from the public in getting access to the data? Is that
all the time?
All the time.
Yeah.
Dave, do you have thoughts about a review on radiation monitoring stations generally, or about this more specific question of public availability of the data?
The public availability is generally good, but there's a strong caveats on this one, in that the validating and vetting process, if the public perceives that as you're pulling out the bad data and only presenting the good data, even though there's valid reasons for perhaps, then that's a big confidence hit that's hard to recover from. Patrick mentioned that the state is training people to help other states if they need, because there's a shortage of people. There's even a shortage in the public. I'm a nuclear engineer. I wouldn't understand those numbers, whether to shelter or evacuate if I saw it. So I don't want that. That doesn't help me. Mm-hmm. I want to have trust in the people who are telling me that decision. I think there's other ways of gaining that trust than me looking at the data.
Okay. During his presentation, Joe indicated that NEI supports the draft final rule for mitigating beyond design basis events. Does UCS have thoughts about the draft final rule?
To be honest, we haven't looked at the draft, neither Ed or I got to it yet.
Yeah. Okay. Let me ask one more question, just to follow up on something you mentioned in your presentation. On the idea of the 8 vertical slice inspections, can you just talk a little bit more about what you have in mind and how that compares to the inspections the agencies are already doing for mitigating strategies and the staff assessment the agency is doing on the flooding side?
Sure. The role model I had, or the template I had in mind, was the inspections that the NRC did after the Millstone, the design basis events issue back in the mid-90s. The NRC sent out teams to, I think, 17 or 18 nuclear power plants to look at how design basis information was translated into operating procedures, training, maintenance procedures, et cetera. And they found some problems at certain plants that had to be fixed, certain broken widget that had to be fixed. But they also drew some insights more broadly into a lot of the findings had to do with calculations and calculation control that were then built in or factored into the inspection program, the routine inspection program. So I think a similar effort here, a deeper dive on flooding protection and mitigating strategies, could reveal individual problems. But the bigger value from that would be to gain confidence in what parts of the baseline inspections are effective and what tweaks may be necessary to sustain that effectiveness going forward, or improve or sustain that effectiveness going forward. I think if we continue the status quo, the inspectors are looking at whether there's a flood protection barrier there or not. They're not then pulling the string to make sure that it's properly designed and maintained to be there. They're basically a checklist, is it there or not? The deeper dive will ensure that that's the appropriate barrier for that penetration or that pathway. And again, if those inspections show that that homework's there, then we just continue it. If it shows there's a recurring theme, then that leads to a different fix more broadly.
Thank you. Thanks.
Commissioner Burns.
Thank you. Thanks, all. Thanks for the presentations. Sort of reflection on the response to Fukushima. I think one of the interesting things, and I think both our industry representatives and Mr. Lockbaum for UCS touched on it, is one of the benefits we see is sort of a standardization. I think back to post-TMI. I mean, one of the big arguments was greater standardization across it. But this is an area perhaps where we've really achieved it in a way, and I think need to sustain it, because I think they've sort of touched on this, and I think Joe and Bill as well, is that there is a way of learning from what we see in terms of how the equipment is implemented, and of course, I think one of you mentioned, I think we all have gone, I mean, it's been one of those things, on my list and going out to plants that, go see what they've done. And also had the opportunity to see sort of internationally, and it's very, very common, but particularly for a large fleet like that in the United States, nearly 100 operating plants, in addition the National Response Centers in Phoenix and Memphis. I think that's in terms of a lesson learned, or what's impressive about that is that sort of focus on this greater or broader standardization across the response. You know, granted, each plant where things are is different, but the notion of, for example, the color coding on some of the cabling, the type of equipment you have there. I appreciate the comments that have been given here this morning, because I think that really, for me, reinforced that aspect. One of the things we've spent a lot of time, and I want to ask a few questions on, is more off on this, on the flooding and the other natural hazard evaluations. And Joe, I'd like to ask a clarifying question on, I think it's your slide 4. And I may have missed the explanation, but in the beginning it talks about 85% completion of the responses, the 5054F requests, and then 100% mitigation strategy assessments complete. And I'm trying to understand the numbers. Are we talking about two different things there? If you can help me out, I just may have missed it in your talk, but.
There's two aspects to it. There's the one where we actually did the evaluation of what the new flooding hazard would be. So in essence, what would you have to protect against to be able to implement the mitigating strategies and what the consequences were to the plant. In some cases, they're not totally complete because there's an aspect missing. The plants have made the evaluation on whether the aspect is still missing, so I can't submit it to the NRC yet until I get the complete data, would impact their ability to implement mitigating strategies. They've done that determination and went through that they could still do the mitigating strategies for those. So that's what the mitigating strategies assessments on why that's 100% complete, although not everything's been turned into the NRC for the 5054F, because in some cases there may be a data point that we don't have, but doesn't appear that it will influence the outcome of the evaluation. Is this an incomplete data point for me to submit?
Okay. And in the seismic area, I know this, I remember early on, one of the challenges always, I think, in the seismic areas is the number of experts you have to do the kind of work that needs to be done. Is that continuing to be a challenge, or you see is industry see itself in a fairly good position?
Well, we haven't got any more experts, or we might have got a couple out of that, but we've been through most of the evaluation.
Okay.
So the plants that had either no change or minimal change, their evaluations are complete more. So now the focus is on the plants, on the seismic probability risk assessments, which is the more complicated part of the evaluation.
Okay, good. And Bill, you talked about the importance of knowledge transfer in this area. So what are the types of things that you're doing you think that need to be done to assure that, because, there are fewer of people like me, and particularly those who left and came back. And so what is it that you need to, what is it you need to do? And I think, Dave, you touched on this as well. What's the strategy? What's the success path in that?
One of the interesting things about particularly flex equipment and some of the things we've done is they are a very recent analysis and things. So we're not talking about somebody did this in the 70s and now we need to transfer that knowledge to another generation. Quite frankly, I've got an individual behind me, Adam, who's here. He leads it for Brunswick, if he'd raise his hand, please. And he's not of the same generation I'm from. And so I think it does paint a picture that we, across our organization, have pulled these experts in and everything. But now, if we're able, and I believe we'll be able, to keep this very real going forward, to me, the best way to learn is always hands-on. You can take all the classrooms in the world, but until you touch it, and what we're working very hard is to make sure that across all aspects of the operators or engineers or maintenance people who need to touch it, we're giving them that opportunity. And so I don't envision that at least the lessons we've learned from Fukushima, the equipment that we've got in place, is going to be a challenge from a knowledge transfer position, because literally they're the ones learning it almost from the beginning.
Okay. Yeah.
I do want to correct one. 2017, all the mitigating strategies assessments will be completed.
Okay. Thanks. And Mr. Mulligan, I appreciate the dialogue on this question on public release or when, how do you communicate, you know, actual readings to the public and like. I'm wondering if in one of the considerations is in what kinds of units that it would be actually, because I tell you, my old OECD NEA buddies used to jab me all the time about we Americans and our millirem and rem versus the becquerels and millisieverts and all that. Is that one of the considerations? Because that would be, actually, if we had an incident here and translating it for, I think, some of the international community, that might be an issue. So I don't know if that's one of the considerations that goes through people's heads as they think about how, you know, how and when and in what form to report this.
Yeah, it took me about 24 hours to get on the Sievert scale when I was looking at Fukushima. So, yeah, that's one of the things I mentioned was context.
Yeah.
So when you're putting out data publicly to put it in context, that would be units, what units actually mean. And then putting units even in simpler terms of what that means to the public, you know. So putting data out in context, and that includes units and what health effects and those kind of things. Those are the kind of issues we're struggling with, because it's not easy to put that in terms that almost anyone from the public can understand. So that's the struggle right now, is doing that.
Okay. And I know some of the I think it was some of the, for example, recently with the tritium spill at Indian Point site earlier this year. When you look at the numbers, because you start to talk about tens of thousands of whatever the unit was, picocurie. Tens of thousands. I mean, most of us it says, that's a big number, you know, type of thing. So, I mean, I just sort of emphasize, sort of underlines, I think, the challenge, but appreciate the sort of the work on that. Because I think a lot of good, just regurgitating information doesn't always help people. So being thoughtful about the context and trying, again, with the objective transparency, but also assuring that really with the right thing that needs to be communicated about protective actions, whether it's sheltering, evacuation, or the like, I think that's important. So I appreciate your work on that. And my question was answered, Dave, on the vertical slice. And I do remember I was actually cleaning out some old files and found my old copy of a millstone report a couple of weeks ago. So I may go back and look at that. But I appreciate that, because that was one of my questions that you answered. Thanks, Madam Chairman.
That's okay.
Sorry,
I've been yes sir'd a time or two
I know,
in this building in my time here, so that's all right. Did you have anything additional? Okay. Well, once again, thank you to each of the panelists. And we will take a brief break, perhaps about 10 minutes after. So 5 minutes, 10 after, we will reconvene. Thank you. All right, if we can reconvene and get started, I will hand it over to Mr. Mike Johnson to start the staff's presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, Chairman and Commissioners. We're pleased to be here today to talk about the status of the Fukushima Lessons Learned activities. As has been noted several times today, we are very close to the 6-year anniversary of the accident at Fukushima Dai-ichi, and in the time that has passed, we've accomplished our goal set out by the Commission of having a majority of the safety enhancements in place at U.S. nuclear plants by the end of calendar year 2016. I'm going to leave the details of the actions that we've taken and the results that we've achieved to the members of the panel that I'll introduce in a minute. I want to focus, if I can, for just a minute or two on the high-level overall lessons learned activity. First, it really was an enormous endeavor and a tremendous accomplishment. As the longest serving member of the steering committee, I can remember the early days after the accident and the early days after the near-term task force report, thinking about sort of projecting ahead on the significant amount of work that we would have to take on. We'd need to evaluate the task force recommendations, of course, and identify needed changes. We would need to address several policy issues and raise them for consideration. Of course, in some instances, and with stakeholder involvement, we would need to identify potential new requirements and new guidance. And in addition to that, we would need to develop an approach and an overall schedule for the implementation of that, those requirements and guidance. Licensees would need to develop plans and submit those plans to us. We would need to review each of those plans, and ultimately licensees would need to procure the equipment and make the modifications to change the procedures and train on them. We would need to document our review of the acceptability of those plans and verify the implementation through inspection. And we needed to do all of that with a sense of urgency, but with sufficient technical rigor so that we could do it right the first time, while ensuring that we didn't distract from other priority activities that were ongoing. Well, so with the work of the staff and the industry and other stakeholders and the Advisory Committee on Reactive Safeguards, in over 300 public meetings, as we've described, or it was described in the previous panel, with more than 20 public meetings between the NRC Steering Committee and the Industry Steering Committee, with over 30 meetings with the Advisory Committee on Reactive Safeguards, with close collaboration of our international partners, and of course, with the direction and oversight of the Commission, we counted, I think, about 40 Commission papers and over 15 Commission meetings. With all of that activity, we did it. That's my first high-level conclusion or statement I wanted to make. Secondly, over the 6 years, folks who took part or were present at the early stages in the endeavor, many of those folks left to take on other assignments. And so we've continually had new folks join us. It was true for the steering committee. It was true for the Japan Lessons Learned division, director and then division. It was certainly true on the part of the working groups, the external hazards folks, for example. And it's true, I think, as you heard in the earlier panel from Joe Pollack, true on the part of the industry. Despite the significant turnover of individuals, both on the NRC side and on the industry side, we maintained continuity of purpose and continuity of direction. We maintained focus and momentum throughout those changes, and I think that is significant. Third, I think you're gonna hear in the presentation today that the effort really demonstrated our ability to integrate separate but related activities to seek and identify insights based on lessons as we were moving through implementation of the activity, and then to self-adjust towards more effective outcomes. I think that was a significant accomplishment throughout this lessons learned activity. And then lastly, the effort demonstrates our ability to innovate, for example, to make changes to processes and procedures and approaches to address challenges that we projected. And so you'll hear those examples. You'll hear how we were able to do that to, again, achieve the success that we have achieved. Slide two, please. Immediately after the accident, we established a near-term task force in response to Commission direction to review NRC processes and regulations to determine whether the agency should make improvements to our regulatory system and to make recommendations to the Commission for its policy for policy direction. The task force concluded at that time that continued operation of the fleet and continued licensing activities did not pose an imminent risk to public health and safety, but they also presented a number of recommendations. And this slide lists the categories of those recommendations and the specific recommendations. But also on the right of that slide, it emphasizes where we are on dispositioning each of those recommendations. And as you can see, we've dispositioned almost all of those recommendations, and those few that remain are on a closure path. And so as a result, I agree with some of the statements of the first panel, safety has been improved. Next slide, please. In our presentation, we are going to provide you additional detail of our progress, what implementation looks like today, and what we've left to do. First, Bill Dean, who's the director of the Office of Nuclear Reactor Regulation, is going to provide an overview of the Tier 1 status implementation. Mike Franovich, who is the acting director of the Japan Lessons Learned Division, will provide an update on the status of the remaining Tier 1 activities and an overview of our assessments regarding the Tier 2 and the Tier 3 activities. And then finally, Tim Reed and Eric Bowman walk us through the mitigation of beyond design basis, external events rulemaking. And so now I'll turn the presentation over to Bill.
Thanks, Mike. Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners. It's a pleasure, as always, to be here this morning, and in particular, Chairman Savinicki, for your first turn at the helm, even though it's probably like your 1,000th commission meeting.
Probably something like that, yeah.
And I do apologize in advance if I stumble over titles as we go through Q&A, but anyway.
I have to interrupt you now. I printed out something yesterday, and I grabbed it off the printer, and it said the chairman approves whatever. And I'm like, well, this is Burns's. Where's my email? And I'm just like, wait a second, that is mine.
So anyway, so the next slide, please. This slide should be fairly familiar to the commission. We've been using it for, almost since the beginning, I think. And it's proved to be an effective slide to provide a snapshot of where we stand in terms of our efforts to complete the Tier 1 activities, which were the ones that were of most substance and safety enhancements. And so, obviously, this demonstrates that we're well along, as Mike indicated in his opening remarks. So let me talk about these in segments. So with respect to the orders, 85 of the 99 operating plants are in compliance with the 12049 order on mitigating strategies. In essence, really, all of the plants have met the requirements, except for the fact that the 14 BWRs, Mark 1 and Mark 2 BWRs, still have work to do in terms of coming into compliance with the containment vent orders. And for those sites, there's a close relationship or interrelationship between the vents and the mitigating strategies. So while they have put in place all of the equipment and the strategies to date, until they complete their vent orders, which is still another year or two away, they can't claim victory relative to the mitigating strategies order. But in essence, all of that work has been done at all the sites. With respect to the spent fuel pool instrumentation, all plants, with the exception of Fitzpatrick, are in compliance with that, and Fitzpatrick is an outlier because of the fact that their path until very recently was to shut down. They had asked for an exemption from that. So they have plans to get in compliance with that order later this year. So by the summertime, we should have all the plants in compliance with the spent fuel pool instrumentation orders. And then with respect to hardened vents, as you all know, there are two phases to that. There's the wet well phase, or phase one, and the dry well phase, or phase two. At this point, about 20% of the plants are complete with their phase one work, and we expect by the end of this year, 70% of the plants to be complete with their phase one wet well venting, hardened severe accident capable vents. And then we're well ahead in terms of the pace, in terms of coming into compliance with phase two. I think you're aware that all the plants that have to come in compliance with that order plan on using water addition strategy and not to install a specific dry well vent. And so we expect them to be well in advance of the 2019 backstop for those orders. In the area of the 5054F request, or the reevaluations, with respect to seismic reevaluations, approximately 50% have completed this work, and that will continue over the next several years. In terms of flooding hazard reevaluations, we've received all of the flooding hazard, reevaluated flooding hazards from all the licensees. We do have two sites remaining, Beaver Valley and Brunswick, that have some complexity to them that we are specifically focused on in terms of completing our evaluation of their reevaluated flooding hazard. Once we give that to those sites, then they can then begin developing their mitigating strategies assessment. So, and a matter of fact, Mike, just a week or so ago, was at Beaver Valley specifically to walk down the site with his counterparts from the Office of New Reactors and to work with the licensee to make sure we have a alignment in terms of a forward-going strategy at that site. I will mention one thing in terms of flooding hazard that we're seeing is a number of licensees are queuing up to provide us with a revised reevaluated flooding hazard. So that's something that we're going to have to deal with in terms of how do we look at that information in an efficient and effective manner and not have it distract us from the primary mission that we have in terms of getting through the mitigating strategies assessment. So that's something that we're in conversation with the Office of New Reactors and the staff there in terms of how to do that efficiently and effectively. Mike's gonna talk in a little bit about where we are with Tier 2 and Tier 3, and then Tim and Eric are gonna touch on the mitigating beyond design basis event rulemaking. And so those obviously are centerpieces of our post-Fukushima response. And I will say the commission obviously has knows that we have two papers in front of them, and we certainly look forward to your feedback and your direction as a result of those two commission papers. And hopefully today's meeting will help clarify or answer perhaps some of the questions or issues or concerns that you might have. So hopefully we can help in that regard. Before I turn it over to Mike, I do want to provide a couple of comments or observations. So first of all, in a little bit, Eric and Tim are going to talk to you about the rulemaking. And those two individuals, as well as Howard Benowitz from OGC, I think have done a phenomenal job in terms of leading the staff effort. A lot of people have contributed to that rulemaking. It's a substantial accomplishment, and I just want to recognize their efforts collectively in leading that effort and developing what I think is a very coherent rulemaking to the commission. Over the past several months, Mike Franovich and I have had the opportunity to actually participate and observe several of the TI-191 inspections. These are the inspections that the regions are doing to evaluate and validate that the licensees have indeed implemented what they committed to in terms of the mitigating strategies order. And it's been very impressive not only to see the quality of our inspectors and inspection teams and the way that they are inspecting licensees implementation, but also the robustness and the capability that exists out there, not just for mitigating beyond design basis events, but how this equipment might be used in other ways. And I'll talk to that later on in our presentation when we talk about flex. And then the last thing I want to mention is just the recognition of the entire division over the years. It started off as a directorate, grew to a division. And now that a lot of the major work, and particularly much of the major policy issues have been brought forward to the commission, particularly with the rulemaking and the Tier 2 and Tier 3, while there still is remaining work to be done, and substantial and important work that Mike's going to talk about, collectively, the JLD organization has done a phenomenal job, I think, in terms of managing and working through a very complex, involved, and evolving environment. And so, you know, my compliments to them. You know, we're looking at, obviously, with the decline in some of the workload, reshaping JLD, and then our plans are in beginning of fiscal year 18 to downsize the division to two branches. And it's an important to keep those two branches solid for some period of time because of the knowledge management that they have, the knowledge transfer that needs to occur. And so it's very important that we keep that collective group together because of that corporate knowledge that they have. And I think Mike will talk later about some of the KM-type work that we plan to do. So with that, let me turn it over to Mike and tell you about coming attractions.
All right. Thanks, Bill. Good morning, Chairman and Commissioners. Go to slide 5, please. Pleased to tell you that implementation of the mitigating strategies order is nearly complete, as you've heard from other panelists. We have completed on-site audits at each of the U.S. plants. Nearly every plant has notified us that they comply with the order's requirements. We've now issued about half of the site-specific evaluations, or safety evaluations, documenting our assessment of the licensee's strategies. And the regions continue with their inspections to confirm order compliance. We have now completed about a quarter of these inspections and have identified no substantive findings to date. We credit this to the thoroughness of the audit process, including the week-long on-site audit that is done by a multidisciplinary team of experts, and also to the dedication of licensees to improve site safety. Looking toward the future, we have developed and are implementing a plan to transition the JLD activities to long-term oversight. The plan outlines roles and responsibilities and provides for enhanced knowledge transfer opportunities. This plan assures consistent implementation through deliberate cross-regional engagement. To ensure the benefits of these safety enhancements endure, we are updating and developing inspection procedures to incorporate beyond design basis features in the reactor oversight process. The procedures will be informed by the lessons learned from the ongoing mitigating strategies inspections. If I can go to the next slide. Okay. Regarding the BWR Reliable Hardened Vent Containment Order, the order entails two phases, as Bill Kapp described. Phase one requires licensees to upgrade containment wet well venting capabilities. The upgrade ensures that the hardened vent can operate longer, have better hydrogen control, and can function under severe accident conditions in order to remove heat and to better preserve the containment function. For phase two, it requires a similar dry well venting capability. Phase two entails either installation of a dry well vent that can operate under severe accident conditions or implementation of a containment venting strategy that makes it unlikely to need to vent from the containment during a severe accident. No licensees to date have elected to install a dry well vent as an option. We have reviewed licensees' plans for phase one and phase two and issued interim staff evaluations well ahead of schedule. Maybe I should pause here for a moment just to refresh memories about the ISCs themselves. We did develop the ISC concept starting with the mitigating strategies order. The ISCs provide a licensee a degree of assurance regarding acceptability of their plans. This approach enables licensees to move forward in a timely way with equipment procurement and installation in advance of issuing our safety evaluations. We are now working with the industry to expedite closure of the remaining open items. Well, as licensees complete their analyses and finalize their designs, they will provide appropriate information for staff review using the audit process and the electronic portals. Staff will develop the safety evaluations as the open items are closed to expedite the completion of these documents. In addition, industry and staff are developing templates and for submittals and regarding the safety evaluations and are coordinating when information becomes available to more efficiently use resources. We will inspect the sites after they are in compliance and have received the safety evaluations, similar to what we're doing under mitigating strategies order approach. A draft inspection procedure is now under development, and we expect the compliance inspections to begin in the mid to late 2018 timeframe. If I can go to the next slide, please. Slide seven. We have continued to make steady progress in the area of seismic and flooding hazard reevaluations. All sites have submitted their analyses for NRC review. For seismic, we issued the last of the staff assessments at the end of last year. We are now focusing on assessing the impact of any hazards that exceed a site's design basis. The majority of sites with exceedances will perform limited scope evaluations, such as assessing potential fuel pool impacts. Fewer than one-third of the U.S. plants are preparing seismic probabilistic risk assessments. We expect to receive the first of these over the next in the next month. The remaining sites will make their submittals on a staggered schedule to allow us to best utilize and optimize our resources. For flooding, we have sent nearly every site its hazard acceptability letters, with the exception of Beaver Valley and Brunswick, as Bill noted, informing them that the flooding levels to use for the subsequent evaluations. These letters are then followed up by full staff assessments documenting the technical basis for the conclusions in the letter. We have now issued over half of the staff assessments. Licensees that identified exceedances in the flooding level will also perform additional analyses to they'll do either a focused evaluation or they'll do what's called the integrated assessment. The results of these will also be put into our phase two decision-making process to determine if backfits are appropriate. In addition to recommendation 2.1 process, the reevaluated hazard information will also be used to show compliance with the upcoming mitigation beyond design basis rule, as directed by Commission SRM COMSECI 14-37. Most sites have evaluated their mitigating strategies against their reevaluated hazards. We have begun reviewing these assessments and will continue over the next 18 months. Next slide, please. So regarding Tier 2 and 3 recommendations, we have completed our final assessments of the remaining Tier 2 and 3 recommendations and submitted our assessment to you for your consideration through SECI Paper 16-144. Recall that the majority of the Tier 2 and 3 recommendations were previously closed in SECI Papers 15-137 and 16-41. The remaining recommendations require additional assessment or development of a resolution approach, including stakeholder interaction before the staff can determine a firm disposition path. Over the past several months, we've discussed these final recommendations with our stakeholders, including the public, industry, state and federal government agencies, and the Advisory Committee on Reactor Safeguards. For two of the three recommendations, natural hazards other than seismic and flooding, and real-time radiation monitoring, we have recommended no further regulatory action. For ongoing confirmation of natural hazards, we concluded that the NRC can meet the intent of near-term task force recommendation 2.2, which is related to periodic assessment of hazards, using a more efficient approach than a proposed rulemaking. We have recommended enhancing existing processes and developing associated staff procedures. The proposed framework will ensure that we proactively and routinely aggregate new external hazard information, assess new information in a systematic and predictable manner, and inform appropriate regulatory programs promptly about new hazard information that likely affects safety. The proposed framework has three components, the first being knowledge retention activity that preserves and leverages the hazard information gathered from various regulatory reviews. Second, a continued collaboration and coordination with stakeholders, including other federal agencies. And third, an assessment activity which includes aggregation evaluation of significant new information, as well as referral of potential significant issues to appropriate regulatory programs, like the generic issues program. The full details of the framework are proposed and described in SECI 16-144. With that, I will now turn over the presentation to Tim Reed, and Tim will cover the mitigation of beyond design basis events rulemaking. Tim?
Thanks, Mike. Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners. As the slide states, and go to the next slide, please, the draft final mitigation of beyond design basis events rule would integrate into final regulation the key requirements that stem from almost 6 years of our ongoing efforts to address the events in Japan, of course, in 2011. I think it's very clear from the discussion today that the majority of these safety improvements have, in fact, either been complete or are about to be complete as a result of implementing the ongoing Fukushima orders and the associated license conditions for new reactors. So the question arises then, what's the rulemaking doing that's different? Well, the rulemaking would make generically applicable these key requirements, and by that, we place into the regulations predictable, stable requirements. And we have advantage here because we can learn the lessons from the ongoing implementation. We've folded that into the infrastructure of the rule, and we also, of course, have benefited from the external stakeholder feedback that's been provided as part of the rulemaking process. So once the regulation's in place, then we no longer have need to use orders or license conditions. So I think the graphic on the slide then depicts the approach we've taken. As you know, and in fact directed, we have followed a performance-based approach to address these events for beyond design-based external events. That has in turn enabled a flexible and adaptable mitigation capability put in place, and that fits well with beyond design-based external events. And this approach is similar, of course, to what we did following the events of 9/11 for power reactors. So then the objective then of this mitigation beyond design basis events rule is to take this work and produce a coherent and integrated set of requirements that reflect the lessons learned as well as its feedback. And I think what we provided you in draft final form has accomplished that task, that objective, excuse me. So since we issued the proposed rule in November of 2015 for a 90-day comment period, I think it's been improved significantly. And that's a benefit, a credit to the folks who provided the feedback on our proposed rule. We've simplified it, we've clarified it, we've aligned it with its guidance. I think there's been a lot of improvements there. So as a brief overview then, I'll walk through the rule at a very high level here. That'll sort of set the table for the remainder of my discussion and Eric's discussion on the rule. It's structured first, as most rules are, in Part 50 to contain applicability provisions in Paragraph A. It's followed by the integrated response capability requirements in Paragraph B. Then really the rest of the rules there support that. So we have equipment requirements, we have training requirements, we have drill requirements. We have the spent fuel bowl monitoring requirements set in there really by themselves. Then we have a configuration management provision as documentation of changes in there also. As most rules do, we have a scheduler and compliance provision in there. And then finally, we have a paragraph that would rescind orders and facilitate the removal of the license conditions. So that's the structure of the rule. I'll talk about the applicability portion, the scheduler and compliance portion, that last paragraph to rescind orders and remove license conditions. I'll finish with the integrated response capability requirements, and I'll hand it off to Eric, and he'll finish that rule and also talk about the supporting guidance. So that's the plan. So I'm going to go to the next slide, please. So I just mentioned we followed a performance-based approach, and I think it's better really understood. I think Mike actually mentioned earlier, it's really enabled licensees to implement innovative approaches. I think most of you folks have been out there and seen this. It's pretty impressive. And it fits with their specific facility designs, their events, their operational practices, their external events, and that's enabled the safety improvements to be put in place while minimizing what otherwise would be a larger amount of regulatory impact and cost had we followed a more prescriptive regulatory approach. So I think it's been very good. This slide also talks about our broad view. What are we talking about there? Well, as you know, very well know, we looked at all the ongoing regulatory actions internally. We tried to, on several different actions with the commission, consolidate those down to what became the mitigation beyond design-based events rule. I think that directly led to our development of the rule and producing a more effective, efficient rule. So that's the inside look. But I think the more important look is how we viewed the rule itself. We were thinking the entirety of the reactor life cycle, not just the beginning when you scope applicants and licensees in, but the end of reactor life. So we have built in decommissioning provisions from the get-go. So that's some of our views there. We also were very mindful of the fact, and this is always the case when you're making generically applicable orders. So you know at the end state, you're going to be dealing with a rule at least and orders. In this case, we have unfortunately have a very complex circumstance because we have orders and license conditions and a rule. So we were mindful of need to address that end state also. So let's talk about the first paragraph, paragraph A. That's the applicability provisions. The draft final rule applies to the same sets of licensees and applicants as the proposed rule. And those are operating licensees under Part 50, combined license holders under Part 52, and applicants for the same. Applicants for operating licensees under Part 50, and applicants for combined licenses under Part 52. No other licensees and no designs, for example, on power reactors. Now, having said that, designers are certainly free to address our regulation if they choose to. And in fact, as you're probably aware, we do have such an example in house right now. And moving on then to our decommissioning provisions, what's referred to as phase out on this slide. These decommissioning provisions reflect the recent decisions we've made on decommissioning. So there's no new regulatory territory carved out there. However, what is new is we built them into the regulation. And so what that means is licensees no longer would have a need to request exemptions and the staff would not have to review those. It would happen as part of the regulation. So this would, I think, would result in less resources spent. And that's, by the way, another mindset we had throughout this, thinking about everybody's resources. So that's a very good provision in the rule. The approach in the final rule is the same as it was in the proposed rule. It's basically at a high level, it's a three-stage approach. Simply put, once you remove the reactor fuel from the vessel permanently to the spent fuel pool, clearly now your mitigation strategies come down to your spent fuel pool. So you can simplify it there. Once you get to a low enough decay heat that you basically have a lot of boil-off time, time to take ad hoc measures to sustain function, you can now move down to the extensive damage mitigation guidelines portion of our rule. Now that stays in place until the spent fuel pool is empty of all fuel, which typically when you move the dry cast storage. So at that point, then all requirements cease. So it's the same approach as the proposed rule, but I think you'll find hopefully throughout the regulation that we've clarified and improved the language in paragraph A. So moving on then to our scheduler and compliance provisions, that's paragraph H. I think there's two things interesting about that versus the final rule that were not in the proposed rule. First, the flexible scheduling provision. When we put the proposed rule out, we were very well aware of the challenge the licensees would face in trying to address the reevaluate hazard information within the proposed two-year compliance period. So we actually requested feedback on how to address that issue in the regulation, in the proposed rule. We got a suggestion to use a flexible scheduling provision. We liked that suggestion. We worked it into what you find in H2. Okay, so what that means is that provision only applies to addressing the reevaluate hazard information. In other respects, we think I'll call it default compliance period, which is 2 or 3 years, I'll talk about in a moment, that should be sufficient for everything else in the rule. In terms of licensees who want to voluntarily use that flexible scheduling provision, they would need to first show good cause they cannot comply with the nominal 2 or 3 year compliance provisions in the rule, and then provide a proposed schedule and supporting basis for that schedule. Okay, so then here's some more of that mindset again on resources. We structured this to be approved unless we notified to the licensee to the contrary within 120 days of submittal of that. So that's the same mindset that we built throughout the regulation. Another interesting feature of paragraph H is, and I just mentioned, we have a 2 or 3 year compliance provision now in the regulation. This 3 year is new. This applies only to licensees having boiling water reactor designs, GE designs with Mark 1 and Mark 2 containments. This is feedback we received in our final rule CER meeting and CumaFlex regulation meeting. So this is, in fact, directly reflects the fact that these folks are implementing the CER accident capable venting order, EA 13109. The venting system obviously is a very important part of their mitigation strategies. If they were to have to comply within 2 years, they would likely have to do procedures more than once, training more than once. So this is basically giving them that extra year. As you'll recall, that order was issued in June of 2013, more than a year later than the orders that we're making generically applicable part of our rules. So this will avoid that unnecessary distraction, unnecessary resource expenditure. So I think this is the CR process working very well for us. Moving on then to paragraph I, last paragraph in the rule. This is our, as you'll look at, it's a set of requirements that would rescind the orders and support the removal of the license conditions. I mentioned briefly, but going back to that again, when we integrated everything into this rule, we not only have post-Fukushima strategies and guidelines, we have the post-9/11 strategies and guidelines that were implemented about 10 years ago for 5054HH2. So we're bringing those all in. As a result, there are license conditions and orders associated with both. And those license conditions and orders are completely redundant to the new rule we're going to be putting in place. So what we want to do, and by the way, we got feedback on this issue as part of our CER questions. There was confusion as to what would apply when. And so this is our effort to address that feedback. What we would do is try to transition from the effective date of the rule out to 3 years. And at 3 years past the effective date of the rule, then our rule would establish the only set of requirements for all the applicants and licensees to which this rule applies. So we're rescinding orders and removing license conditions in a disciplined process so there's no regulatory gap that occurs anywhere throughout that process. We built it into the regulation because we believe that'll save resources. Obviously, the highest approval you can get is the commission. The most information to support this is in that rulemaking package. So we think this is the way to get it done and lessen resources on all people's part. So that's the objective of paragraph five. Next slide, please. So I'll go on to now the paragraph B. That's the integrated response capability. That is truly where Eric and I started when we started developing this regulation. So the regulation really is built around it, and everything really is there to support that. So as you recall, these are the requirements to develop, implement, and maintain an integrated response capability. Now, the draft final rule has 2 or possibly 3 guideline sets associated with it. The proposed rule only had 2, and so I'll focus on that difference. The first set of guidelines and strategies in the draft final rule are the FLEX strategies, and these by volume are clearly a large majority of this regulation. And these, of course, are to address or mitigate beyond design basis external events. They're there to implement order EA 12049, the mitigation strategies order. Those were in the proposed rule, they're in the final rule. The second set is what appears to be new. These are seismic and flooding mitigation strategies and guidelines, and they can include event-specific approaches. Now, these, frankly, in most cases, will be FLEX. In other words, you can take your FLEX as is, address these scenarios without change, or there'll be a modified version of FLEX. Again, FLEX can do what it needs to do. It can also address these strategies. In which case, you're not going to have a different set of strategies. You're going to have FLEX, or FLEX modified, if you will. But they can involve event-specific approaches. That's allowed, the flexibility in this regulation. And if that involves strategies and guidelines, then you could have another set of strategies and guidelines. So, as you know, these only apply to the operating licensees. The new reactors are designed to these standards, so this is not an issue for those folks. And it only applies when the calculated values using the new methodologies exceed their external design basis for flooding and seismic. So that's the second set. Then the third set is what was also in the proposed rule, and that is the extensive damage mitigation guidelines, or it's what's referred to as the post-9/11 strategies. As you know, we're simply relocating those into this regulation, recognizing the overlap with the FLEX strategies, And also recognizing the fact that any proper integration, you do need to consider those guidelines and strategies. So that's the final rule. So what appears to be new, of course, is reevaluated seismic and flooding strategies and guidelines. And really, it's not new. The actual regulation had this flexibility built into it in the proposed rule, but it was built into the guidance. Now that guidance is still there in the final rule. What we've really done is aligned the regulation now with the guidance. So the same flexibility that was there is now reflected in the regulation. So this is, I think, a good example of improving a final regulation such as much more clear and understandable. Moving on then to the rest of paragraph B, the next provision is the same provision basically that was in the proposed rule, and that was the requirement that these strategies and guidelines need to be integrated with the symptom-based EOPs. And I said with, an emphasis on with, the symptom-based EOPs are step-by-step procedures. They were put in place following events of TMI in the 1980s. The strategies and guidelines have more flexibility as you need to address beyond design-based conditions. So they're fundamentally different, but nonetheless, we can integrate them, recognizing those differences. The next provision was also in the proposed rule. You have to have, obviously, sufficient staffing to implement this integrated response capability. That's in the final rule, of course. And then the last provision is really a command and control provision, if you will. You have to have an organization that directs the staffing to implement this integrated capability. So that's the structure of B. So I round out B, and I'll hand it off to Eric, and he'll talk about the rest of the rule and the supporting guidance.
Thank you, Tim. Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners. I'll be discussing the portions of the rule that support the integrated response capability that Tim mentioned, as well as the guidance supporting the rule. The draft final rule contains requirements that support the integrated response capability. Some of the supporting requirements are directly linked only to the flex strategy and reevaluated strategy mitigate the reevaluated hazards portions of the strategies, as opposed to including the post 9/11 B5B strategies. There are reasons that I'll go into why we're treating the two sets of strategies different as far as the supporting requirements are concerned. As Tim mentioned, we're just moving the requirements from after 9/11 from where they exist now in Part 50 to the new section 50.155. We are not changing anything with what the requirements are, and we're sensitive to the need to meet the backfit rule if we move anything that's currently existing in guidance for those requirements from the guidance level to the requirement level. The first of these supporting strategies have to do with the capacity and capability of the equipment. In paragraph C, the equipment that supports the mitigating strategies, the flex strategies, are required to have the capacity and capability to perform the functions that they're designed to accomplish. The post 9/11 strategies, that capacity and capability is designated in the at the guidance level. Similarly, the flex equipment has a requirement for reasonable protection. It actually has two requirements for reasonable protection against natural phenomena. One of the requirements for the equipment that supports the flex strategies that were originally developed under the mitigation strategies order is against the design basis natural phenomenon. And there's a new one for the reevaluated hazards that came out from the seismic and flooding portions of the request for information, the 5054F letter. They're specific to the different things that the equipment will be used for, because we have seen in the implementation process that licensees have developed some event-specific strategies for addressing the flooding hazard or the seismic hazard. They can use the equipment for specific hazards, so we've laid it out so that they can have the reasonable protection for the phenomenon that the equipment would be used to mitigate. In the post 9/11 strategies, that again is in the guidance level. It's set in the guidance level by a selection of the storage locations as compared to what would be potential targets of a hostile action. The other difference is communications capability is also required to support the flex strategies, but not the post 9/11 strategies. Again, that is in the guidance level for the B5B post 9/11 strategies. Next slide, please. The second area, a couple of these areas Tim already mentioned because they were included in paragraph B instead of paragraph C. There are other supporting requirements, the staffing to support the strategies. In this case, the staffing is in the rule is designated to support both the flex strategies and the post 9/11 B5B strategies. The reason we were able to cover both flex and B5B with the staffing requirement has to do with the 2011 Emergency Preparedness Enhancements rulemaking, where we had required a staffing analysis to show that the on-site, on-shift personnel were capable of performing the functions they were assigned, including the B5B strategies, as well as the emergency preparedness efforts. So we already had the requirement from that rulemaking. And similarly, we had in that rulemaking the imposition of a requirement for periodic, on an eight-year cycle, exercises for the B5B strategies. As you'll see in the rulemaking, those requirements are being moved from what we had proposed in a new Section 7 of Appendix E to Part 50 into the new Section 50.155. Additionally, there is a training requirement to train the staff that will be performing the strategies using the systems approach to training in order to ensure that they're capable of performing the functions that they're assigned to perform for the strategies. One part of the requirement for the training that we've included is we've allowed a cutout, if you will, for training that's already considered responsive to an existing requirement. For example, the flex strategies do, in general, for some of them, require the use of flexible hoses that the response personnel would have to roll out and connect that are essentially the same thing as a fire hose that would be used in a fire protection program. We've got existing fire protection training that covers how a licensee needs to train their personnel on how to put out fire hoses, connect them, and ensure that they will function. We aren't asking licensees to go back and revisit whether or not that training is adequate because it's supported already by a regulatory program. Any other similar types of things where there would be elements of the strategies that already exist in regulatory programs, they don't need to redo using the systems approach to training. Next slide, please. As Tim mentioned, we've included the need for a remote monitoring capability for the spent fuel pool level instrumentation. We had previously in the proposed rule had that as supporting to the mitigating strategies. It's been moved to a separate section within the new section 50.155 that is separate and distinct from the mitigating strategies. That's because of the genesis from the two separate orders. The spent fuel pool instrumentation order, as you recall, was for the prioritization of actions between the spent fuel pool and the reactor elements of the casualty. At the guidance level, the spent fuel pool instrumentation and the mitigating strategies are fairly closely linked because the spent fuel pool level instrumentation at the guidance level was set to be able to function in the same context that the mitigating strategies would be used. However, it wasn't required to be used for the mitigating strategies. And similarly, the guidance level for the mitigating strategies points to the spent fuel pool level instrumentation. We're leaving that as it is, where a licensee can continue to rely on using the spent fuel pool instrumentation that was initially installed under the order EA 12051 and will be required under the new portion of 50.155. And a licensee that does that would therefore have that equipment subject to the same requirements that are in the new paragraph C, as because then it would be equipment relied upon for the mitigating strategies.
However, it's not mandated that they interlock the two requirements, if you will. Next slide, please. There are three regulatory guides that are supporting the rule. These regulatory guides draw heavily on the interim staff guidance that was issued for the request for information that was sent out at the same time as the post-Fukushima orders, and also the updates that we've had to make to the interim staff guidance as a result of the lessons that have been learned in the implementation of the mitigating strategies order. The first of the regulatory guides is Regulatory Guide 1.226, which covers the flex strategies. For the B5B strategies, we have not developed a new regulatory guide. In 2014, there was a section that was added to the standard review plan, section 19.4, that covers those strategies, and that guidance remains the same. Regulatory Guide 1.227 covers the spent fuel pool instrumentation. It essentially carries forward the interim staff guidance from the spent fuel pool instrumentation order without any substantive changes. And finally, Regulatory Guide 1.228, which covers a lot of the remaining portions of the rule. It addresses the issues of integration of the sets of strategies with the EOPs, the command and control, training, and drills. It also provides guidelines for the performance of staffing and communications assessments that carry forward the assessments that were done for the request for information on that subject. And finally, in addition to providing regulatory guidance for how to comply with the draft final rule, these regulatory guides, 1.226, 1.228, and the standard review plan in particular, are responsive to the direction you provided us on the proposed rule to ensure that there's appropriate coordination in the guidance with the severe accident management guidelines. With that, I'll turn the presentation back over to Bill. Next slide, please.
Yeah, thanks, Eric. Yeah, next slide. So real briefly, as I mentioned earlier, from the visits that Mike and I have recently made and to the sites and having a chance to see firsthand the flex equipment, it also has allowed me to be able to visualize and evaluate or assess firsthand how this equipment could be utilized in other ways besides for a beyond design basis external event. So the staff has been hard at work in terms of developing, revising our guidance documents that will help incorporate flex in areas like how could you use flex for credit and significance determination process determinations, how could you use flex, for example, in making a decision on a notice of enforcement discretion, and how it can be utilized in licensing applications. And we've also begun work based on commission direction in terms of how could flex be integrated into, for example, security-related areas. So while this guidance is under development, we are making practical use of it now. We've leveraged our existing processes. For example, the recent emergency license amendment on Palo Verde, where they had the failure of their emergency diesel generator, we were able to leverage licensee's application of flex and incorporate that as both a defense in depth measure as well as how it could be accommodated in a risk assessment and basically supported a decision where we allowed Palo Verde to extend their allowed outage time for the diesel to 62 days. So, and then also, licensees are incorporating flex into their PRA models. And as they do that, that will provide us with a more consistent and reliable capability to basically leverage flex in some of our licensing decisions. Before I turn it over to Mike for the last comment, I do want to recognize this individual on my right, Mike Franovich. Mike, last summer, actually had been selected for an SES position in the Office of New Reactors, and I implored Jennifer Ewell at the time that when Jack Davis departed, I really needed to sustain the corporate knowledge and leadership that Mike had been providing to this program. And I think that was one of the best decisions that Jennifer and I cooperatively made, was to allow Mike to stay in position. Mike will be going over to his new job now in a couple of weeks, but he helped shepherd us through these very important policy activities and to get these in front of the commission. I just want to personally thank Mike for his leadership and his willingness to stay with us to see this through. So thanks, Mike. Mike.
Thanks, Bill. So as you've seen in the presentation today, the great majority of safety enhancements are now in place in the U.S. fleet, and the U.S. fleet is better prepared to cope with extreme events. What work remains is on a sound path. We believe continued focus is warranted to make sure that we complete those activities that remain, and we'll devote that focus. As we discussed, the policy issues have been substantially resolved. The draft final mitigation beyond design basis rulemaking package and the final Tier 2 recommendations. Closure plans are with the commission. Our next steps with respect to sunsetting, the Japan lessons learned steering committee and completing the transition to the line are imminent. And so as we complete the transition, we're placing additional focus on knowledge management and knowledge capture so that Tim and Eric and others can ultimately retire. We want to make sure that we ultimately at some point, we want to make sure that we capture not just what we did, but the rationale behind we did it, why we did it. And so that's what is involved in our knowledge capture activities. I want to conclude this presentation with just a tremendous sense of pride that we feel, all of us, I think, with respect to what we've been able to accomplish. So with that, we're ready to take the commission's questions.
Thank you all for the presentations, and I'll pick up where you left off, Mike Johnson, to say, observing this as a member of the commission throughout these events, I'm also very proud of the NRC staff. At a speech at our regulatory information conference a few years ago, I talked about how proud I was of our country for the fact that its reaction to what on TV, you know, is a very hard thing to watch, the events that happened at Fukushima. We were allowed as a federal government agency the space, the breathing room that we needed to apply the technical rigor and the discipline to a set of actions that were going to have the kind of safety improvement effect that we analyzed, and we were allowed the space to set implementation schedules for those that were not so quick that they were a distraction from the day-to-day operations of those plants. And I'm proud of that as a very reasoned reaction to something, again, that was hard to watch was happening to our friends and colleagues in Japan. But we were provided that space. I think we made excellent use of that space, and so I also want to commend the staff. And I mentioned in the previous panel that it was, by my estimation, hundreds of NRC experts and staff with a direct involvement, but it was probably, you know, 1,000, 2,000 when we take in the indirect support that is needed and all the different functions that provide support so that the Tims and the Erics of the world, you know, can do the rulemaking activity that they do. So I think it will stand in the history of this agency as a tremendous body of work to have done this. And by the way, there were lots of other things going on for us in that time period. So let me begin with that, and it is important, and I think in this moment it's good to recognize that. That being said, I still have some questions that I'm going to direct to you. One of the areas of concern going forward for us in sustainment is a little note I wrote to myself here when the previous panel was talking about knowledge transfer and the generational shift, the turnover to successors that come and take our jobs. I wrote, are regulatory interpretations well documented? And I'm going to tell you what causes me to be focused on that in this moment. In my first couple of years of service on this commission, I joined the agency when it was deep, deep into codifying the post-September 11th security orders. And this is a term near and dear to many of us. Oh, we're just going to codify some orders. So some of the experience in that process was we codified the orders, but with additional things. Now, let me be clear from the start. You get into the implementation of something, and you cannot proceed mindless of the lessons you learned, the moments of, gosh, if I knew then what I know now, I would have written this order slightly differently. And it's not all just originating from NRC. Many of it is, you know, people have implemented the things that we've directed them to do, and we both learned lessons in that process. But as an agency, it's important to bring discipline to that process of, I'm not picking on Tim, but I wrote some of his, he said, improving the final rule and lessons learned in implementation, because we could sit as the regulator and introduce a number of new measures. I appreciated that both Tim and Eric were specific about being sensitive to backfit, about looking at the things that increased the efficiency and effectiveness in moving from the orders to the rule. But that being said, we will have people who will come along in the future, whether it's the actions taken post 9/11 or today. The other thing to navigate is this split between what do you bind us to in the rule language itself and what do we put in guidance. And Tim and Eric talked quite a bit about how they tried to navigate that. But that discussion also takes me back to that very first question. Are regulatory interpretations well documented so that all of our successors don't get together and say, between the commission's vote, their staff requirements memorandum, the direction to the staff, where we ended up in rule space, I find myself now on issues, you know, I go back and try to take the mosaic of all of that. It's like the equivalent of a legislative history in the Congress. You know, people gave floor speeches, people wrote committee reports. How do I stitch that together into saying the intent and clear intent of the law is X? So we have a version of that as regulators. Would anyone speak overall to the approach to that, to making sure that an inspector in the field 10 years from now knows the regulatory expectation for X or Y that arose out of the Fukushima response?
No, that's a great question. I'm going to hand it off to Mike in just a minute, but it's something that we've been extremely conscious of, and you talk about the lessons learned from the 9/11 and the order implementation. Of course, Tim has some of the scars, I think, from that activity that I think he was very conscious of in terms of how this rule was developed. But in terms of knowledge management, knowledge transfer, we actually have a handful of specific actions that were taken to do exactly what you identified, is that this ultimately is getting translated into the regions, and the inspectors are going to be the ones that are going to have to basically approach the sustainability. So maybe I can let Mike talk a little bit about a couple of initiatives.
And Mike, before you do, let me just at a high level also make the point. So we were mindful of both of the things that you raised. One, about what happens when you codify and things can grow. In fact, I remember very vividly some of the early steering committee meetings with the industry steering committee, where we talked about this plan to codify and how do we make sure that we exercise discipline in that process. And so the emphasis that we've placed throughout the process to make sure that we didn't grow, that we applied backfit along the way, we looked at what is necessary if we're going to make these improvements. I think we did due diligence, and we got great input from external stakeholders where they thought we got it wrong.
And let me be clear, the codification is absolutely necessary. I don't like us to be regulating for decades at a time in order space necessarily. I mean, there are instances where it's one-off, but where it's generic, we need to move to codification. I'm pleased that we did that. And if you can move to codification with a lot of the same people, it's best.
Yes. The other thing I was going to make, point I was going to make is, there came a time when we were thinking about, from an expediency standpoint, whether or not we could afford, for example, to do safety evaluations at the back end, or whether we needed to get past those to get to inspections. And I remember very vividly, maybe Bill was engaged in that activity as a member of the steering committee as well, where we said, you know what, 10 years from now, some inspector in the field is going to be looking at what we did, and they need some sort of a beacon or some sort of a stamp about what we thought about what licensees were proposing to provide consistency and stability going forward. And so I think again, that's an example of where we were mindful of the challenge and we took actions to address it. Please, Mike.
Thanks, Mike. That's a great place to for me to start off with. Have been in the field. Sometimes you get a vintage plant and you're trying to interpret the original licensing basis, and sometimes it doesn't have that level of detail or documentation to go with, and then you wind up in a protracted process calling back headquarters and writing agreements to try to make those interpretations. So the safety evaluations is essentially one of those lessons learned. Let's make sure we spend the time appropriately and be very clear and detailed as to what we looked at during the audits, what the position papers were that we supported, whether they were white papers presented by the industry or our own generated white papers, and that we use those products to inform the TI 191 inspection, so the inspectors actually take it in the field and we work with them on inspection plans. So go look in this one area that maybe we the audit teams didn't spend as much time, vice the areas that we've already documented in the SER. I mean, there are other layers of KMKT, knowledge management, knowledge transfer. For example, we are working on a new reg to document a lot of the lessons learned from the JLD staff itself. Fortunately, we have Eric Bowman with us who lived through the 9/11 legacy when the commission directed we need to have more of a KMKT effort in that arena. So we were able to leverage that experience as well. The reg guides are another set of documents that obviously take clear staff positions on interpretations of industry implementing guidance. So it is a myriad of documents. And the last thing I'll note in the training arena, we are trying to leverage what industry's done, and we actually have under our MOU with IMPO, where they have a set of online video, training videos regarding the FLEX program. So we want to incorporate that. Those features into our own qual program for inspectors and for staff. So those are a few of the features that we're kind of working on right now.
I appreciate that, and that's helpful. You didn't mention, but I also would credit the reintegration organizationally and otherwise of a lot of this work into the standing line organizations, I think is a sustainment measure. I know I've evidenced a certain amount of impatience about that over the years, but it is happening now, and I think if this is the time that the staff determined is comfortable and appropriate to take this, you know, the phasing is, I guess Savenicki needs to be patient and say we're getting there eventually, and we did get there. The one other thing, and I only have a few seconds left, but we haven't talked about this, although Commissioner Burns did raise the issue of all of the international collaboration that's gone on since the accident in Japan and the fact that regulators have collaborated and cooperated. We talked to each other. Some countries did stress tests. Some countries did. There were changes in nomenclature, but I think at bottom we discovered that the post-Fukushima set of areas of concern had good parallels around the globe. But we have had very special and intense integration of things with the our Japanese counterpart as the government of Japan looked after the accident at restructuring of various organizational and process elements of their oversight of operating reactors. So I would ask Mike Johnson or Bill, at a high level, is there anything you'd want to say about how that's evolved? Areas, I know that the area of resident inspection is something of interest to our colleagues in Japan, and they're looking at our model a little more closely. So just at a high level.
Sure. Thanks for that, Commissioner. We have had a lot of international collaboration and certainly in various international committees through NEA and IEA and others, as well as distinct interrelationships with our counterparts in Japan. One of the things that we're currently doing right now is hosting five individuals from our counterpart, the NRA organization in Japan, to basically firsthand evaluate the way we conduct our inspection program. And so they've been out in Region 3, and Region 3 and Region 4 have been sharing responsibility for hosting them at various sites and inspections. Next month, they will come to headquarters and be here for several months and get with the program office and understand sort of the program office focus. And then we're having dialogue with them about future cohort group coming over again to learn from us so that they can integrate that into their planning and efforts to refine their or revise their oversight process.
Thanks, Bill. And of course, on the other side of that, Japan and our regulatory counterpart in Japan has provided tremendous ability for us to look from afar to gain insights as they gain insights into what happened and how do we prepare to make sure that never happens again. That's been a long-standing, close engagement that we've had with them, and it's been very beneficial.
Thank you both for that. Thank you, Commissioner Barron.
Well, thank you all for your presentations and more importantly, for the years of work you all have been doing to implement post-Fukushima safety enhancements. I want to, there's really so much material here, so many ways to go, but I think I'll focus my questions on the staff's proposed resolution of the open Tier 2 and Tier 3 recommendations. One open item is an evaluation of natural hazards other than seismic and flooding hazards. And after applying a screening process, the staff focused its more detailed analysis in two areas, high winds and snow loads. I thought the high wind analysis was pretty thorough, so I don't have questions about that. I want to ask about the snow load evaluation, which isn't as lengthy. The staff identified five northern plants that could have issues with heavy snow loads on plant structures like roofs and other things. And the staff concluded that no additional action was needed at these sites, in part because they have procedures to take precautionary actions prior to winter events and to monitor potential adverse effects at the sites. The staff's paper didn't really describe the procedures, though, in any level of detail. Do these five plants have detailed procedures for removing large amounts of snow from plant structures? Who does it, with what equipment, and what time frames?
I'll take that question. You're right. The actual SECI paper doesn't have a great amount of detail on the snow load aspect, especially about characterization of what we looked at in the procedures. We did look at some of the procedures. We did not, as a staff, put a heavy reliance on them because we took more of a structural analysis type of approach and looking at margins available, in particular looking at the ASCE code and looking at how, whether it's a BWR, which may have more susceptibility to snow load on the roof, versus a PWR. So we put more emphasis on the structural analysis and capability. When it came to the procedures, all the five plants you've mentioned, they do have procedures for clearing roadways, ensuring that the operating crews can come on and handle the turnover if in case they're snowed in, sufficient personnel, emergency response capability, et cetera. Not all of them had detailed procedures regarding snow loads on roof, for example. So I wouldn't, that's why we didn't put a heavy reliance on that, that particular element. But we went back to the structural analysis piece.
So the staff wasn't concerned about the lack of detailed procedures in that regard because of margin and the structural analysis you did.
That's a fair characterization.
Okay.
Yes.
Another open item I wanted to ask about is an evaluation of the efficacy of real-time radiation monitoring at nuclear plants, and we discussed this at length on the first panel. And I mentioned at that time that the staff's evaluation cites a 1982 study that concluded that a monitoring system consisting of 16 or 32 stations couldn't provide reliable information about a potential radioactive plume. And from my point of view, there's nothing wrong with looking at the studies that are out there and have been done over the years, but my expectation is that the staff's going to take a fresh look at the effectiveness of these monitoring stations. Did the staff take the next step and examine how many stations would be necessary for a radiation monitoring system to be effective?
So you correctly pointed out that it's prudent to start with the history. What have we done as an agency, in particular post Three Mile Island accident? We did go back and look at that, and that is documented in the SECI paper. And it did point out some vulnerabilities about having a fixed station, fixed monitoring capability. While it may be of more utility to perhaps emergency officials who might be able to derive, you know, where the center line of the plume may be falling by sort of vectoring off of different detectors, when it came to actual sharing that information with the public, we're looking at it from a sensitive standpoint. What do you do if you have a real-time monitoring capability that's publicly available where it might give false indication of true dose? And so there were issues like that. We went back and looked at, we sought stakeholder input. I think that's documented in the actual SECI paper itself, to get the different perspectives, because there are advantages to such a system. Mm-hmm. So we didn't go back and look at, you know, let's say you had a 32 detector system and we did any kind of sensitivity studies or anything like that to see if that would be a better system. We were sensitive to the fact that there are, in the federal enterprise, other capabilities, for example, with the Environmental Protection Agency and the RadNet system. As you're probably familiar with, there are more than 130 fixed stations across the country. There is a portable deployment capability as well, and actually that has served, from a federal perspective, some useful information when we're looking at, for example, the Chernobyl event, which was mentioned by the first panel, regarding the plume and contour maps going across the United States at the time. So there is value in it, and we are aware of what else is in the federal enterprise, but we didn't go back and do any kind of updated analysis, because ultimately we look at initial protective action recommendations are really primarily based on the plant conditions. We want an earlier warning type of approach rather than relying on deposition of radioactive material. Although there's value in having that information, we'd rather have operators declaring early from an emergency standpoint, if I see imminent core damage, I want to start making some recommendations to the local and state officials. I don't know if maybe Steve Levy was the principal author of the study, if you have any more to add to that.
Okay. Thanks.
What Mike said was pretty is correct. One of the things I wanted to point out is in this 1982 study, they did consider the difference between a 16 station and a 32 station. And as I recall, I'm standing here trying to remember what the number was, it was only about a 5% improvement in the reliability over the 16 station. Recognizing, of course, you just doubled the cost of the system. And making it even a higher resolution just keeps multiplying costs on a system which is probably not is not going to be result in a substantial increase in public health and safety.
Well, I guess I take your comment on the role that you know these the monitors would play. What I want to make sure as an agency we're doing is we're really grappling seriously with the recommendation that the near-term task force had, which is they had an explicit recommendation. We as an agency should take a look at the efficacy of monitoring systems. And while there's value in going back and seeing what you know a 1982 contractor study determined about that, I would expect that we'd go further than just that if we're going to take a fresh look at the effectiveness value of these systems. And I could see various ways to do that. One way would be to look at it and say, okay, well, how many monitoring systems, you know, with today's technology would you need for an effective system, and what do we think the cost of that would be? You mentioned cost, so it sounds like we didn't really look at, well, if 16 or 32 isn't enough, how many would be? On the cost side of things, you know, the staff briefly discussed that in the paper. It provides the 1982 costs for the system from this study, and then it asserts, and it's the quote, quote, given inflation since 1982, the current cost would be significantly greater, end quote. And I don't know, I think that's a pretty odd statement to make. It's, first of all, it's conclusory. There's no analysis behind it, but it just asserts that, well, the only factor is inflation, but I think we'd all agree that there have been some pretty significant technological advancements in the last 35 years in the area of sensors, data communications, battery power sources. And I would imagine that you could probably get a monitoring station today with more capabilities at lower cost than you would have in 82. And that's we heard that from Mr. Mulligan on the first panel, that he thinks the stations you get today are more reliable, have more capabilities, probably cheaper than the ones you would have gotten in the 80s. Did the staff look at the current costs of radiation monitors?
No.
Okay, and so to me, and you know, this is maybe kind of a blunt question, but if you didn't look at how many stations would be needed for an effective system, and you didn't look at the cost of the monitoring stations, how can you be sure that they wouldn't be a cost-beneficial substantial safety enhancement?
So if I can take a shot at that, Commissioner Steve, if you don't mind, from a high level, and I appreciate your comments and your remarks about, you know, how detailed an evaluation did we do on this. But I think that we looked at it from a much more higher level global perspective, and that is from a perspective of protecting public health and safety. The key is, what is the PAR decision or the PAR recommendation that a licensee is going to make, and when does that occur? That occurs well before there is any release or a need to have any off-site radiation monitoring. And so a decision to shelter in place, a decision to evacuate, the way the EAL schemes are developed is that those recommendations would be made well in advance, because you want to evacuate people before there's a release and there's a plume, right? So to then have to potentially require licensees to invest resources, no matter you know whether it's $1,000 for a monitor or $25,000 for a monitor, there was not going to be any substantial increase in protecting public health and safety. There may be an increase in the potential for additional knowledge to be available, but there's other means that already exist for doing, you know, you have teams that go out and do plume surveys. We have the capacity for FERMAC to come in from FEMA to do, whether it's flyovers or whatever, to get information about where the plume is and so on and so forth. So it was, I think, viewed, and this would be my perspective, it would be a nicety to do that, but that there was no way that we could make a justification, for, no matter what the cost was, that this was something that was needed for adequate protection for public health and safety, or a cost-beneficial substantive increase in safety.
Well, so. I want to push back on that a little bit, because what that sounds like is a disagreement with the underlying premise of the recommendation, that this is really something that's important to look at, and then kind of jumping to the conclusion that, well, it's not important to look at it, and there's no way it could be a substantial safety enhancement. I mean, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but that's kind of how I interpret what you just said. That's not grappling with the recommendation. That's saying it's not a good recommendation.
Right. So Mike's going to interpret for me. Mike.
What I was going to say is that we took every one of the recommendations that were made seriously. And I think the approach that Bill laid out is exactly the approach that we had in mind. We started with such an approach, is something necessary for adequate protection based on the recommendation? No. Would something represent a substantial increase? And then would it be cost justified? So implementing the 5109 as a way to look at this. And so that's why we didn't get the cost. We didn't get the cost for all of the other reasons that we've talked about what exists in the current framework and what would be needed beyond that to result in a substantial increase. And we didn't see it.
I'd like to address the commissioner's comment about we're deprecating the recommendation. In the recommendation language, the paragraph that preceded it, the task force specified, as long as field teams are adequately staffed, equipped, and capable of transit, given the nature of the natural disaster, field monitoring remains an effective method to acquire radiation data.
But yet they then went on to recommend that we take a fresh look at the efficacy of real-time monitoring, right?
Well, I want to separate real, I don't want to separate. We did look at the real-time data, and based on the studies done in 1982 and the recognition that the technical basis of that analysis was still valid, not the dollars and cents, but the plume dispersion is plume dispersion. It's science. It's physics. The location of the monitor in relation to that plume. An elevated plume in a boiling water reactor will pass maybe at least 1,000 feet above the monitor. And I agree with my colleague from New Jersey, there is plume shine, but not as much, what they were referring to in the study was getting a reliable indication. And they said, we can't get a reliable indication under all conditions. And therefore, they believed it wasn't worth the effort. The staff apparently at that time agreed because they retracted the requirement from Reg Guide 197.
But I'm over on my time, but I just want to follow up and kind of close the loop on this. So the 1982 studies there, is there new analysis? I mean, you basically said that the science hasn't changed. The staff believes those conclusions are still valid. Is there supporting analysis for the staff's new conclusion that the 1982 findings are still true today?
Well, if the basis of the conclusions is valid, one would assume the conclusions are also valid. But I want to point out and emphasize, and even in the paper, that conclusion was only one of the aspects we considered in making the recommendation.
Let me ask about quickly on one other aspect. I mean, one way to do this is how many monitors do you need and how much do they cost? Another way to do it would say, hey, there are monitors operating right now in New Jersey and New York and Illinois. Did the staff evaluate the effectiveness or capabilities of those systems that are active today?
Those systems, as Mr. Mulligan pointed out, do provide data that could be useful. But our question is, do they substantially increase the public health and safety? Having confidence in response actions and having transparency are wonderful things. But what? How do they help us with the criterion substantial increase in public health and safety, when everything we see already in the plants provides that assurance? The NRC's protocol for relying on plant condition. The NRC's been relying on plant conditions ever since TMI. They've always downplayed the use of assessment. Now, once the event is going full force and you start to get that data available, by all means, licensees are expected to use it. But our initial protective actions, the most protective part of it, are done on plant condition.
So if I may add to that, just, I mean, granted, we did leverage the 82 study. It is informed by the outreaches to the EP community and emergency preparedness specialists and experts through various forums to get their input. I would also say we leveraged the experience actually at Fukushima itself and how effective that system was at the time, given shifts in wind. But the other thing we leveraged, and may come out clearly in the paper, but in the backdrop, you recall we went through a very large EP rulemaking here, I think it was about 5 years ago, 6 years ago. And part of that was looking at evacuation times and shadow evacuation effects, if you recall, which is a real known effect. Would such a system, if deployed in a real-time basis to the public, cause some unintended consequences there? These are qualitative considerations, but something certainly in the back of your mind where it's, let's say I had an indicator system out there and it was available on the internet, and public officials are saying one thing, but the indicator's saying something else. Will people make their own decisions and perhaps self-evacuate to a region where perhaps the winds are shifting and the plume is now moving in that particular sector? No, that's not a quantitative piece. It's a qualitative piece. The other thing that's not in the paper, I would say as a manager, that I keenly think about when I look at kind of decisions that we're looking at here in terms of merit for public protection, is that we do have a state-of-the-art reactor consequence analysis. And it does give us some pretty good insights about the accident progression, the effectiveness of emergency actions that are currently in place, and that they are effective, and that the fact that there were orders of magnitude away from the Commission's safety goals in terms of safety were actually much, much better than what the safety goals have provided. So that is context. If we were to do a more rigorous analysis from a cost-benefit standpoint, I think those would be factors that would have to be brought to bear. But we're trying to temper how much do you invest in looking at this particular issue vice doing a more detailed analysis. So I just wanted to provide that for some of the context that may not be in the paper.
No, I appreciate that, and I am way over time, so let me just close and say thank you for mentioning the kind of public availability aspect of this. We talked about that a fair bit on the first panel. It strikes me as a complex, kind of nuanced question. My observation reading, you know, the staff's work here is, other than a statement that says, well, this could make shadow evacuations worse, we don't really grapple with that question or any of the complexities of it. Maybe it's because, you know, you didn't see the merits of the monitoring stations in the first place, even though that was part of the recommendation on the public availability aspect of it. I guess just to close on this, I would say, you know, there are three open items here. One of them was on how do we more proactively aggregate and review and assess new information on natural hazards. I thought you guys did a great job on that. And then high winds, it was really thorough. Snow loads, a little briefer. This, you know, piece doesn't have the rigor of like the high winds analysis. And, you know, it's pretty obvious when you read it, it doesn't have that rigor. And, you know, I'm just not convinced we did enough there on this. Thanks.
Thank you, Commissioner Barron. And that is a complex topic. I know we went a little over time, but I think it was important. It was important to explore that. And Commissioner Burns, if you need a little extra time, please. I might have one follow-up question myself at the end. Thank you.
It just gave me more time to think about what my questions would be. So that may be too bad for the staff. Actually, I want to come back to, I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the, what I'll call administrative law or process issues with respect to implementation of this rule as a, and I use it guardedly, as a codification. I actually worked on the, as well, on the post 9/11 orders, as well as the development of some of the, well, of the rulemaking beyond. And one of the, and I want to, I may ask Tim and Eric a question along these lines. There was a significant difference in terms of the rulemaking that came about probably about the time you got here, Chairman, which was that the initial orders in the security area were clear responses to the 9/11 context. But the interesting thing, and I know my former boss and general counsel, Karen Sear, would be here slapping everyone's hands for calling the security rule a codification of the orders. Ah, you all remember. She was quite adamant about that, partly because one of the significant reasons we had to go forward with the security rulemaking is we had these supposed 31 new applications for new reactors coming in the door that did not have, which would have been entering with an application without, in effect, an updated security framework. We had a security framework that went back probably to my youth in terms of late 1970s and early 1980s. So one of my questions for I think Tim or Eric or anyone is, I don't, in terms of what we're, and I will use the word codifying, what we're codifying now with these orders, my sense is, what's the delta between what the orders did and what the rulemaking does here for the Fukushima? For the mitty-bitty rulemaking.
I'll take a cut, and then I'm sure Eric will chime in as our usual modus operandi. But the order, I view the difference as being the reevaluated hazard effort. That's okay. The difference. Otherwise, I think of the rule as virtually the same as the order. And I like to use the word make generically applicable, and I do that because we mentioned it several times today, but I think we're going to be on about Rev 4 of NEI 1206 by the time we're done. That's become almost 250 pages guidance that reflects all that continual lessons learned. It's gotten bigger and better, right, as we've gone along. And so of course, we have stakeholder feedback, and in this case, it's really improved the rule. That's why I say generically applicable. So I see only the real difference being the reevaluate hazard information. In fact, that's why we have the flexible scheduling strategy there, because that effort's extending out. So that would be my answer to that. So.
I'd go along with what Tim had to say about that, but looking at it holistically, we've gone through two revisions to the interim staff guidance that we initially issued with following the issuance of the order, and that's feeding into the regulatory guides. And there were some clarifying language that's actually in the rule now. For example, the inclusion of staffing as a per se requirement. It was clearly intended in the order where we had a specification, a requirement in the order for training of the staff. You can't have training of the staff without staffing. But it would be something that I would consider potentially someone could view that as a backfit.
So one of the things I want to understand, too, is in terms of the scheduler, and you know, I will first confess I have not started to dive into the rule yet, as I consider part of my weight training program as I take it back and forth to the apartment, my apartment. But in all kidding aside, you know, I'll be taking a close look at it. But What I want to make sure I understand up front, because this struck me as you were all talking, you know, we talk about that the industry has implemented much of what's done. We talk about some of the hazard issues. So what maybe you can explain very succinctly what this difference in scheduling, because it's like all rules come into effect, you know, a certain time. So tell me what really there is an extension of time for, if really anything, versus What I want to get some confidence, we're not really undoing the compliance nature of what the industry has done or what our expectations are. It may be with respect to certain improvements or whatever in the rule. So maybe, Tim, if you can try
start,
to.
Start, and then I'm sure Eric can do better. But basically what you're doing there is you're looking at this reevaluate hazard information, the seismic and flooding scenarios. You're basically looking at whether you can take that information. In fact, it was mentioned in the first panel, you calculate a hazard, then you take that hazard and you see what that means for your mitigation strategies. You know, you're looking, for example, first, whether you can take flex as is. You know, flex has got its own purpose in B1. Now I'm going to take flex and see if I can do these different scenarios. And if I can do all these scenarios without change, you know, it's a great answer, right? If I can do that with modifications and still do both, then I'm back to a single set. So that's a lot of work. It's actually a lot of back and forth. It's ongoing right now. And it's got some time to go. As I think you heard in the first panel, there's some PRA work that's coming in. That's very important for one of the paths in the guidance. That's path 5, if you will, in the seismic information. And so that's really, I think, the main driver. The seismic, I think, is the one that's going to go on the furthest. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where folks will probably need that extra time to look at that information, see what it means for the mitigation strategies, and comply with our rule. And I think giving them this 2 years fits very well with that. So
the only thing I would add is that we've written about it in the statement of considerations as far as what good cause would be for using the flexible scheduling option. Our intent is not to leave any regulatory gaps. We have the regulatory gaps covered to prevent them from existing with the 2 year and 3 years until we have included in the draft final rule the rescission of the requirements from the orders or the license conditions. Good cause for going beyond the 3 years would include licensees, including in their schedule for compliance, their continued compliance with the requirements of the order or with the requirements of those portions of the rule.
Yeah, that's a great point. If you look at B1 in our rule, it's really the order. And so if you were going to extend the regulation, you want to have a schedule goes out past when we rescind that order. I think a licensee has got to say, I have to comply with B1. In other words, the equivalent requirements I'm in compliance with.
Yeah. So. Okay, good. That helps me. Well, one of the things that I compliment the staff in terms of thing is that to the extent that we can remove administrative requirements or basically licensing actions for the sake of licensing actions, I think being creative and looking at that is a good thing. One of the things, though, and this is all, you know, over the year, my experience, and I think a lot of your experience, is you need to be on the same page length. So when we say you can get rid of that license condition, or, you know, the order's kind of issue. The beauty of the order, and actually, I'm a bigger, on the center line, I'm probably a little bit different side of the center line on orders than Chairman Savinicki is. But I understand. I think this is a good effort in terms of bringing into the regulatory framework what was the intent behind these orders, improving it all. But you got to have, you know, we all have to see eye to eye. Do we know, and how do we document what those license conditions or other license requirements, license terms are that we think are, you know, disappear because by force of the rule itself? Because I think that's an important, a mutual understanding has to eventually emerge there.
We took a very hard and strong look at the different license conditions that are out there. And for the old B5B license conditions, it was fairly simple because what the commission found that the new regulation required the same thing that the license conditions did when we did the power reactor security requirements rulemaking. For the new ones, the new reactor license conditions for the ones that received their combined licenses after the EA 12049 mitigation strategies order, there are some pieces in some of them that require a little bit different things that would be verification of as-built stuff like battery capacities and so forth. As you look through paragraph I in the draft final rule, you'll see that it's not a wholesale removal of the entire license conditions that require the mitigating strategies, but there are some exceptions that leave in place the stuff that is a delta between what's necessary for a verification of a as-built new reactor that wouldn't have been in the requirements that were issued in the order and wouldn't necessarily have been in how we thought of putting in the requirement for the mitigating strategies in the rule.
So the key is they have to be truly redundant with the rule. I mean, that's what we're trying to make sure that that's the truth. And so then if that's the case, then you can remove them.
But there'll be some interaction with the licensee about what, as they say, a meeting of the minds on that, I would expect. And then
in terms
some
of the administrative
sort of
removal of the licensee.
Yeah. Okay. If I can, two last questions. First, Tim, you talked about in terms of the applicability of the rule, and obviously with respect to operating fleet COLs that have been maybe issued, but you talked about an exception. I want to make sure you said there's something in-house that might not apply, and I'm kind of want to understand the other universe because I'm wondering if this other universe or the other set, you know, now that we've started getting the, you know, a lot of potential interest in advanced reactor design. So how does that intersect here?
Okay, our rule doesn't have design requirements in them. However, there's one application in-house whose design looks very, very good. In fact, so good, they may be able to address their entire regulation basically by their design. They're actually designed to address an ELAP. That now becomes a challenge because they can address what is really an operational type program in their design. So that's our challenge to figure out how to do that. But that's that issue there. But what I was trying to say is it's not a requirement for folks to do that. Certainly they can on their own free will if they wish to. And certainly designers are motivated to do that. You know, and we've seen a case already of a small reactor that does that, NuScale. So
NuScale, okay. Yeah. Okay, thanks. And my last question, if you will, is Dave Lockdown suggested, I mean, one of the things he suggested, this approach of more of a vertical slice. And I know, I mean, one of the challenges is that, and this isn't, you know, attributing bad motives to staff or to industry or whatever, but sometimes you don't always see things. So I don't know if you had any reaction about thinking to the suggestion that he made.
Actually, Dave Lockbaum's suggestion is quite timely. We have had a continuous look at flood protection just as a matter of point. In fact, since 2012, we've had more than 10 greater than green findings in the reactor oversight process, and we have made modifications to our procedures to put more emphasis on, for example, on seal integrity, service life. Those kind of insights have been woven back into the program. We've also looked at our operating experience program and used smart samples. But we are looking at the long-term transition to oversight and where do we take the insights from our TIs and put them into a long-term baseline inspection program. And so we're trying to balance adding in the beyond design basis capability attributes of what we're doing here with the current program so that we're not impacting some of the safety-related type of focuses on the inspection program. But we're now looking at how to craft that procedure, actually, so we will take that suggestion under consideration. I will note that we did do 8 on-site audits that did a more probative look at how the walk-downs licensees were following the guidance from industry. And on the 2 sites that were noted in his presentation were not in that set of 8. So while it's not exactly a vertical slice in terms of looking at calculations necessarily, it was a little bit more probative look.
Okay. No, thanks very much. Thanks, Madam Chairman.
Well, I appreciate everyone's presentations. There's been such an interesting discussion that I wanted to offer just 2 quick observations. They're not really questions. The first is that I want to maybe clarify, I didn't mean anything derogatory about the use of orders. It's just long been my temperament that the ability to compel individuals or entities to take action is among the most powerful and sober authority that we can be given under law. Therefore, I always approach it with a need for discipline and rigor, but I in no way question the legitimacy of that authority under law, because there is occasionally necessity to operate outside of the transparency of the Administrative Procedure Act and the rulemaking process, and that's just simply a reality. So I didn't mean to be anywhere on the continuum. I acknowledge it, but I want us to always approach it in the way we do, so that we wouldn't even venture near any abuse of the discretion of that massive power that we are entrusted with and should, you know, take very soberly. The other thing that I thought might be helpful is to offer an observation was occurring to me about the near-term task force report. As a member of the commission in receipt of that report, we gave a group of very capable NRC employees, albeit a small group, it might have been five people with one administrative support person. They represented a lot of NRC knowledge, but I don't think a single one of them would indicate that they replicated the entirety of the NRC body of knowledge. And when we gave them 90 days, frankly, in a time period when facts on the ground from Fukushima were still emerging, and I'm talking, you know, weeks and months later, but it took a long time to have confidence that things there had stabilized. We were receiving good information from our friends and colleagues in Japan and assessing that. These folks, though, were trying, while all of that information was still coming in, to do a quick assessment of a pretty broad set of issues. And when we received their report, we, I think, struggled with being sensitive to what we had asked them to do, and that, in essence, that they had not been given the time to really push those ideas through the prism of the regulatory framework, through our processes. And as a commission, how I would represent what we did, and we had lively deliberations about, you know, we've got this task force report, we asked for this thing, but look at all of the constraints we put on these good folks trying to give us this work product, and they did a great job to a person. We were very complimentary of the work they had done. But we knew what was missing. What was missing was the ability for the entirety of NRC's experts to take that report from five very knowledgeable people and put it through that rock polisher of, you know, how does it meet these other constraints? And so, as a commission, we struggled even with the language of that in terms of the SRM and the direction we're like. Is it kind of without prejudice, we give you, NRC staff, this report from other NRC staff? But in truth, you know, there was a thought of, we really want to hand it off in a neutral way and not say, we don't disfavor any of these recommendations, but we were clear that we were not endorsing them even in the form at which they existed. We wanted the body. So the intervening years, when I say I'm so proud of what we've done, because we did take that and put it through the rigor of what everybody else and the hundreds of other experts thought, and we arrived, you know, where we arrived. So I sit here as a person feeling very satisfied with the staff's understanding of that direction and what they ultimately did. So I just wanted to share that. The commission did struggle with it. It was a complex question, but that was where the majority ended up. And so I appreciate the work that you've done on that. And if my colleagues have nothing.
I might have one last one. I mean, Madam Chairman, you mentioned public service at the beginning of your remarks, at the beginning of the meeting, and I just want to acknowledge a public servant who served this agency and the country well, who passed away at the beginning of this week, Harold R. Denton, who was the director of nuclear reactor regulation at the time of the Three Mile Island accident. And I think Harold was an honest, plain-spoken guy. I think we can all take lessons from him in terms of his communication and ability to basically transmit information of a highly technical nature. That was perhaps the hallmark of his leadership, or taking, as Governor Ridge said yesterday, sometimes you get thrown into it and you have to do it. And that's what Harold did. He gained the confidence of the president, President Carter, in terms of being that communicator. And even after that, as we looked at, and you know, we were talking today about recommendations and improvements to safety in the wake of the Fukushima accident, But Harold took that on, continued to take that on as the director of NRR. I had the honor of working with him on a number of things, including post-TMI orders and other implementation requirements, 2206 petitions. In fact, I think I know there was at least one from UCS, which Harold granted at least in part. But it was an honor to have worked with him. But, you know, particularly that was one of those moments when someone's put in the spot where they have to stand up and lead, and I think he did. And I remember him well, and I know a number of the staff who may be here knew him and remember him well as well. Thank you.
I really appreciate that, Steve. I at the seminar, the knowledge management seminar that you just referenced that I talked about earlier, our executive director for operations, Victor McCree, began with a moment of silence over Harold's passing. It's awkward when you don't really know an individual. I know you have a richer set of personal experiences. I met Mr. Denton one time, but Victor and I were talking about it later, and I said, you know, I didn't know him, but what of I know? It's like I look around and I see a lot of Harold Dentons here today. You know, the folks who were in our op center activated 24 hours, you know, we cycled through people. And I feel like in my one conversation with Harold, he was the kind of guy who was thrown into something, but his view would be, you know, any number of my colleagues could have been that guy. And I see that proud tradition here today, I really do, through Fukushima, and just, you know, how the commitment with which people come at things. So I think Harold's legacy is absolutely alive and well, and the people I see in the lunchroom and the elevator here, I think that, you know, that I think is really his legacy. So thank you for mentioning that. And with that, we are adjourned. Thank you.